for their respective duties, they have willingly accepted. And I wish you all the best, both Amrita Madam and Sonali Madam. Hope your webinar will be a very successful one. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, very much for being with us today. I would now request our IQSE coordinator and head Department of Political Science, Dr. Rupa Sen, to deliver the welcome address. Over to you, Rupa Di.
Rupa madam, hello.
Rupa ji,
your mic. Rupa madam, the mic ta unmute
korni na. Okay. Dekhchi. Ek minute dekhchi. Hello, Rupa di.
Ha.
Can you? Ha. Okay.
Ha. 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 Ha.
Ha. Ha. Ha. No problem, Rupa di. Continue.
Okay. Suswagatam. It is a glorious moment for me to welcome you all on this live video conferencing, aka webinar, this evening and engage your minds to a pedagogic exercise on the new normal era, a multifaceted challenge of modern society. This is an initiative conceived and undertaken jointly by the Department of Economics and Department of Chemistry of our college under the aegis of IQAC, unit of the institution. We are honored to have erudite scholars as Professor Abhinandan Chakravarti, PhD scholar, Department of Economics, University of New Mexico, USA, and Dr. Saptaporni Ghosh, Chemistry Project Manager, Framingham Heart Study, Massachusetts, USA, amongst us to share their academic resources, their observations and findings on the domain. So my dear friends, colleagues, scholars, and researchers who have taken time off from their packed schedule to be with us. Here are guest speakers from a different part of the world and make the program a grand success. I hope you will enjoy the lecture session with a difference as much as we have enjoyed organizing it for you. Without further delay, I, on behalf of the college, our respected principal, ma'am, including the webinar organizing committee, extend a warm and hearty welcome to our honorable guests to deliver their lectures and enlighten us with their very own perspective on the said theme and prompt us to view the upcoming new normal situation during and after the pandemic through the prism of your observation and understanding. Once again, my warm wishes to our speakers and my request to you to begin. Over to Amrita.
Thank you, Rupa Madam. I must thank IQEC coordinator, Madam Rupa Sen, for her nice welcome speech. This is Sonali Mukherjee from Economics Department of Hiral Mujumdar Memorial College for Women. Now our speaker is Abhinandan Chakravarti. He is PhD candidate in the Department of Economics in University of New Mexico, USA. His teaching interest is in the field of microeconomics, econometrics, and quantitative methods. He has published so many books. He has teaching experience in the USA for a long time. He has been awarded with National Merit Scholarship by UGC for 2011 to 2014. This very year, in the current year, 2020, he received prestigious Julian S. Duncan Scholarship in Latin American Economic Department of Economics, UNM. He also received many research grants. His numerous awards and honors knows no bounds. So, instead of listing them for you all, I would request Abhinandan Chakraborty himself to give his valuable speech. Over to you, Mr. Chakraborty.
Thank you, Dr. Sharon Mukherjee, for this wonderful welcome. And also to Madam Rupa Sen for calling me professor. Although I am not allowed, I hope to be in 2 years. But thank you all. Thank you to the organizers for organizing this wonderful event. And also to all the organizers at Hiral Mojuna Memorial College for Women. So before starting, I just want to share my screen. Please let me know if the screen is being shared. Can you all view the screen?
Yes, sir. It will start, I think. Yes. It is now visible.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm Abhinandan Chakraborty. I am a PhD student at the Department of Economics, University of New Mexico. So again, a very welcome to this webinar, and thank you to the organizers for organizing this wonderful event. Before starting this topic, I really like this topic: the new normal era, multifaceted challenge of modern society. So before starting to talk about COVID-19, we all know that we are all stressed, and there are many issues going on with economic issues, health facilities, health-related issues, and as well as education-related issues. Today, what I'm going to talk about is mostly about the education system and how can we, get through this stressful times. So when COVID started, the first thing that each government did was a total shutdown or a partial shutdown. And with respect to education, the schools were closed. So this is how the school closures looked like in February, where only China and Mongolia had school closures. China had a localized school closure, and Mongolia had a countrywide school closure. Now, at this point of time in February, we never would have imagined what would have happened two to three months. However, in April, this is the situation that was there, where all over the world there were school closures, a lot of students being affected due to this. And if you look at New Zealand and Australia, they had just localized school closures. And in August, it's the same situation. If you look at India, we still have the countrywide school closures. In this talk, I'm just going to concentrate on India's education system and how should we go forward with it. Now, with this school closure, the first thing or the first effect that came was on students. And the number of students all over the world that was affected were 1,058,000,000 approx students were affected due to COVID-19 and school closures. And if you look at India,
One moment, sir. Apni ki oi PPT ta dekhachen na ekhono dekhate shuru koreni?
Ami PPT dekhachi.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Dekha jacche?
Ekhono to arambho hoyni, tokhon kintu dekha jacchilo.
Kindly ওটা আরেকবার রিপ্রেজেন্ট করুন মাঝে একজন প্রেজেন্ট করে দেওয়ার জন্য আপনার প্রেজেন্টেশনটা অফ হয়ে গেছে
এবার দেখা যাচ্ছে
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ দেখা যাচ্ছে নাও ইট ইজ ফাইন
ওকে So what I was telling was that if you have not looked at this figures, this is how the school closures looked like in February. This was in April, where all over the world it spread, and there were a total school closure all over the world. Either it was localized or countrywide. And this was in August, where India had a countrywide school closures. And I will concentrate on India's education system and how we should go forward with it. The first thing, the first people who were affected were the students. And all over the world, there were 1,058,000,000 approx students that were affected. And if you look at India, there were 32 million approx students being affected. And this is a distribution by male and female. If we look at the school types and the percentage of students being affected by school type, the most percentage concentrated in Indian education system are primary and secondary. So it concentrates of 44.66% and 41.52% of total number of students. This is the a scenario right now that these many students are being affected in India. Now, with COVID-19 happening, the first thing that came into mind was, shifting to online education. And for online education, we need two things, two important things. One is a web device, and the other one is having an internet access. Now, if we look at India, the active internet users are a total of 687.6 million. And this is the 2020 data. Now, this is, the percentage of population using internet in India has increased tremendously. In 2000, it was just mere 0.53%, which increased to 50% by 2020. And if we look at the percentage of households with computer and internet facility, it's not that much. And this is the data from 2017-18 from NSS 75th round. If we look at the rural population, it's just a mere 4.4% of the households having a computer and 14.9% of the households having internet facilities. On the other hand, if we look at urban population, there are a total of 23.4% of households having a computer and 42% of households having internet facilities. So with COVID-19 and shifting to online education, this was a really important thing to have in a household, which every household in India does not have. And this is a problem going forward if another pandemic affects us. So going forward, we have to look into other ways. If not online education, there should be some other ways while moving forward. So this map shows us that this is the number of confirmed cases in India right now, and it's increasing tremendously, where Maharashtra is leading the charts. If we look at the active number of cases, again, you can look at Maharashtra leading the charts. Now, with this, with this particular increase in COVID-19, and if you look at the future, if there is actually no vaccine coming in our way recently, we are hearing news, but if there is no actual vaccine coming our way, we need to rethink of our education system and how should we deliver our materials to the students. In spite of COVID-19 or before COVID-19, India already had some problems with respect to the education system. So AACR, the Annual Status of Education Report in 2019, what they said was, the half of all grade 5 students in rural India could not read a grade 2 text. This is really unfortunate that a grade 5 student is not being able to read a grade 2 text. And this shows the Indian school education system represents a dismal learning scenario. There will be a long-term poverty due to this. There will be inability to read and understand text by the age of 10 or the fifth grade. This is said by the World Bank in 2019. The IMF estimates that to meet the 2030 Sustainable Development Goals of better education and health, India needs supplementary fiscal funding of approximately $1.3 trillion. And this is not just for India. This is also for all other developing countries. But this is a huge lot of money that needs to be invested in both education and health. If you compare the Indian education system with the US education system, the US education system, they didn't have, you know, that much of a trouble for transition from in-person classes to asynchronous or synchronous online mode of, you know, teaching. Luckily, I got a chance to, you know, teach a face-to-face class for this fall semester, but I had to move that to online mode because of COVID-19. But the added advantage that I got was I got to, you know, be in a class, or I was taught how to teach, you know, online. And there are a lot of things that we need to keep in mind while teaching online. And this should be, you know, this should be also a structure of Indian education system to teach the educators or to how to deliver the online mode of teaching. In India, there are a total of 1.5 million educators, and among them, just 10%, you know, had ever used any technologies before COVID-19 induced lockdown. And we all know that, you know, some of us have had some problems at the start of COVID-19 of you know, shifting to online mode of teaching. And the online education, you know, we all know that this is a non-starter for most Indian students as well as for schools. We are used to face-to-face classes. This is a different experience for us that we are having. But going forward, we need to be accustomed with this this form of teaching, because this is just a pandemic that happened in 2019. We might be affected by another pandemic in the coming years. So we need to be prepared for this. India also lags behind, you know, all the other BRIC countries and Sri Lanka, and is also behind the average for developing countries. Female adult interest rate is below the sub-Saharan Africa. And if we think about, and papers have shown that the education outcomes are pro-cyclical. By pro-cyclical, what I mean is that during a time of recession in a country, in developing countries, if we consider India, in recession times, the enrollment rate will decrease. So due to COVID-19 and the economic crisis that will happen, or due to, you know, unemployment, job losses, and whatever not, the enrollment rate will decrease according to this paper. And this is not just one paper. There are many papers showing this evidence. And mostly, the families that will be affected are the financially constrained families, where the adverse effect of economic shock will increase. There will be a discontinuation of children's human capital investment, and mostly children from impoverished families, they're likely to be drawn out of school, because if a family from if an impoverished family or a poor family, the only, you know, earner of the family is losing a job, that household needs to decide of whether to send their children to school or where they can earn some income, to economically gainful activity. And if a child is going to an economically gainful activity at that age, he is bound to sustain some detrimental effect on education and, you know, their long-term earnings. Next, I move on to, you know, a paper that some of our graduate students, fellow graduate students have written. And we have titled this Learning Disruption, Digital Divide and Pandemic Management Measures in India. In this paper, this was a short theoretical paper that we had tried. And we had tried to assess the efficacy of the set of pandemic management measures adopted by the government of India in dampening the pandemic's adverse effect on children's education. So what we try to do here is that we try to find all the pandemic management measures used by India. The first one was the countrywide lockdown, then the closure of all transport services, educational institutes, offices, and then there was strict social distancing with a multifactorial classification of districts into red, green, and orange zones. And this is how, you know, the map looked like at that point of time. And I'm sure that this has all changed to red zones at this point of time in August. However, this was the scenario when we started this paper. And I'm not going into the details of the, you know, the theoretical model, but what we found are, you know, students residing in red zones experience greater disruption in learning as compared to those residing in orange or green zones, which means that the red zone areas were the areas where students, you know, totally didn't, were not being able to go to school. So they had to transfer their mode of education to online mode. And as I showed you that every household or all the households in India do not have an internet service or do not have a web enhanced device where they can, you know, study online. So that adds the trauma cost to that student. In addition to that, if a household is getting if the only earner in the household is getting unemployed, there will be income shocks happening, and then that will lead to disruption or greater disruption in learning, and ultimately leading to, you know, students dropping out of school. So dropping out of school is the effect of his or her father getting unemployed or mother getting unemployed. Now this increases the trauma cost tremendously for a student, and this leads to greater disruption in learning. With provision of online classes, students face a greater decrease in net benefit of education, because some students are not being able to access the online education properly. They do not have a web device or an internet facility, again leading to increase in learning disruption. And also this learning disruption increases with what zone you are in. If you are in a red zone, then the learning disruption will be more compared to if you're in an orange or green zones. This is the main outcome that we had found in our paper. We also need to include some other variables as unemployment, which we had not at that point of time. But this is the situation right now, that all the most of the places in India are red zones right now. So the learning disruption in India will be a huge amount. Now, there are certain problems that still exist in India. Firstly, we all know that we were unprepared. We hurried into an online delivery mode of teaching. Next comes another problem, that in one family or in a household, they have a web-enhanced device, they have a Wi-Fi, that's fine, but just one device. So consider, a middle-class family with two children, a boy and a girl, and they have, limited access to Wi-Fi. They have just one compatible device for the internet. This will for sure lead to, competing users. So what happens is that in that household, the household has to decide that whom to give a preference, whether they should give preference to their boy child or the girl child. Now, literature has found that sex preferences in resource allocation hampers education attainment. And this is a given in India, and this is the unfortunate truth in India, that there is gender discrimination. And in addition to that, if in a household either of the parents is a teacher, he or she might be needing that device to deliver the lectures. So in a middle-class family, just one device, there are three learners or one educator and two learners. They have to decide of whom to give the preference of teaching. And this is unfortunately the truth that most of the households are facing right now. They have to decide that whom to give the preference of learning. And this ultimately has some negative impacts on human capital and lifetime earnings. There is job loss, leading to unemployment and income shocks. The household has to decide whether to send their children to school or to a particular work to get some income, and ultimately leading to accessibility inequalities. So if this continues, there will be a learning crisis that will increase for many countries. And in India, students and teachers were ill-equipped to shift fully online at the starting of COVID-19. Now we have gotten used to some of it, but we have to learn a lot after this also. And another problem that still persists is that in this modern society is that parents are multitasking at this point of time. So they are, you know, child's educator, they're playing the role of the teacher, they're helping with their schoolwork. Also, in addition to that, they're working from home. Now, you know, parents who have nowhere to drop their children at this point of time with COVID-19 happening, they're struggling to return to work. And unfortunately, studies have found that mothers bear the heavier, you know, burden and so suffer a bigger career setback at you know, with COVID-19 happening, because the household has to again decide that who is the one who is going to take care of the child and who is the one who is going to fully concentrate on work. What are the ways of you know, coming out of this? So, you know, online teaching, we know that this is a non-traditional pedagogical tool that we are learning. We already had a face-to-face learning that we were accustomed to, but this is a new way of teaching with COVID-19, and not only COVID-19, there may be other pandemics coming in our way, so we need to be prepared for online teaching. This pandemic will only worsen the situation that India already have if the issue of learning disruption is not addressed promptly. The first thing that we need to recognize is we need to recognize some community-driven support systems that we already have. And not only, you know, we shouldn't be dependent on internet and web devices, because that will not be available to every household in India. If you think of rural India, there might be places where they have, you know, excellent television penetration. Might be that most of the households in rural India will have televisions, either black and white or, you know, color TV. That might be a platform of online education. And this is the model I think Kerala is also using. What they have done is they have made channels free on, you know, cable networks and internet. And this is the one that we need to follow if we want an all inclusive environment for education for all, you know, all over India. And education is a global right. However, with COVID-19, we have rediscovered the fact that internet is also a universal right now. If you think about economically weak, backward students, they might not have a web device or they might not have internet facilities, but they might have some, you know, libraries or anganwadis near to their place where they can gather themselves, and we can try to deliver some lectures to them in those libraries and anganwadis. And this is, you know, a great opportunity for India to build an outline, education for the future. Disruption in children's learning, this is a huge issue in India, and which ultimately leads to a lot of problems. So for the first one is that there will be a huge cost of missing school for children, which is happening right now, that not everyone is getting the online education because they don't have a web device or internet facilities. And the most affected population in India will be girl students. This is an unfortunate truth of India. This will lead to interruption in the human capital accumulation, which has long-term implication, as I already said, that, you know, with the long-term earnings potential. And poor children are, you know, less likely to have Wi-Fi, so they will fall further behind their, you know, better peers who have internet facility a device for that online education. I recently found out that Kenya's government has totally scrapped the whole year of education for the, I think, 2020 as well. So the students will be sitting idle for the whole year. Again, this is not the way to go. This will have huge, you know, impacts on those children. Recently, in an Economist article, I was reading that, and I found that there are 400 million children being offered online classes who cannot easily make, make them. They're not being able to study because they don't have the internet connection. 400 million students in the world is not getting education because they do not have an internet connection. And this is not just a problem of developing countries. I was attending a seminar recently, and I got to know that in US also, there are certain places where internet facility is, you know, not there in a household, and they're still facing the same problem. Might be it's not nothing compared to a developing country like India. Maybe the percentage of households not having internet facility is a mere 0.01%, but still in developed country also the same problem is there. And this is a great opportunity for India to build an, you know, better outline education for the future, because COVID-19 is just a pandemic that has happened right now, but there may be, you know, more pandemics coming to our way. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you. Thank you. Is there any question? I find no question in the chat box. Okay. Thanks, Abhinandan Chakraborty, for such a nice presentation. You rightly mentioned about many problems in India due to the difference of family income, sex, etc., etc. Now, may I request Amrita Banerjee, Dr. Amrita Banerjee?
Yes. Hello. Yes. Sure. Yeah. Hello. Yes, Sonalidhi. I am here. I also want to thank Abhinandan Chakraborty for such a wonderful lecture. Thank you so much. So now our next speaker for today is Dr. Saptapurni Ghosh. She did her BSc and MSc in chemistry from Jadavpur University. Thereafter, she joined Shaha Institute of Nuclear Physics for her doctoral research in biochemistry. She pursued her MS in clinical research in Boston University and is a project manager at Framingham Heart Study. She has published in several peer-reviewed journals and has several awards and recognitions to her credits. She has presented in many national and international conventions. Being senior to me, both in Jadavpur University and Shaha Institute of Nuclear Physics, she guided me many a times during my academic career. Today, we are privileged to have her with us. Welcome, Saptapurnidhi. Over to you.
Okay, can everybody hear me?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, and can you see my screen?
Not yet. Can you share it once more? Yeah.
Okay, let's see. Let's try doing this again. Okay. Well, we are all in a learning curve, aren't we?
Yes, yes, definitely. This is all a very new experience for all of us. Seminar to webinar, conference to web conference.
Exactly.
So I can ask our technical team to help you. Just a minute. Atri or Pooja, can you just guide Saptapurnidhi a bit to share her screen?
Yes, Didi. Ma'am, kindly click on the present now on the right-hand side of your screen.
Right.
Then, ma'am, select a window.
Mm-hmm. That's what then, I'm doing, and it doesn't show me my presentation. That's where I got confused.
No, ma'am. You will get a share an application window option pop up on your screen.
Yep.
select the window screen, the screen which is showing. One screen will be shown in a menu within that box.
Okay.
Just click on it and click the share option. Your screen is presenting, ma'am.
Okay, great. And can you see the title of the presentation?
No, ma'am. Just now maximize your PowerPoint.
Yes, that's what I did. And then?
No, ma'am. Your screen can't is see it, presented, right? But if PowerPoint just... is not yet...
Let's see. You're just seeing a black screen, right?
Yes, ma'am. With you are presenting to everyone.
Right, this one and everybody's name below. So when I click on the PowerPoint presentation, it's not showing up.
Ma'am, please minimize this screen.
Okay.
And maximize the PowerPoint.
Okay, now?
It is actually a white background. Just wait for a minute. Maybe it will...
Not yet?
No, no, ma'am.
I am in the presentation mode, so probably...
Should I forward your presentation to our technical team? Will that be helpful?
I probably made a few changes to it, but I can...
Okay, no problem, no problem. You can just... that you can do meanwhile, and you just...
Ma'am, can you please once again reopen your PowerPoint?
Yep, it's open.
No, ma'am, just close this window and just reopen it. I hope it will solve the problem because it's just showing a blank screen, white background.
Okay, so I did the stop presentation and let me do that again.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yep, now it came up. You're correct. Ah, the times we are living in. Can you see it now?
Yes, perfect. No, yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you so much. Well, yeah, we are all
everything
learning.
Everything is fine. Yeah. Thank you.
So, firstly, thank you, Amrita, for the kind introduction. And I missed, I think, about 5 minutes of the previous talk, but that was really a very nice talk. We are talking about a global pandemic. We are talking about being in this whole mess altogether, but it really shows that we are not. There is a stark difference, and there will be people who will be left behind in this, and we all have to try our best to make sure that we progress together as a society, keeping in mind the poorer sections of the society, the people, those who are not privileged enough to have an internet connection. This also probably shows that the three things that we grow up learning, that food, roti, kapra, makan, as we say it in India. And now I think we have to add to that a smartphone device and also uninterrupted internet connections. Well, having said that, this is the new normal. We'll have to deal with it. And we are doing the best we can. Everybody around the globe is doing the best we can. So today I'll be presenting one of my recent research works, which was published in the journal Oncologist. The title of the talk is, and also the paper was, Effects of Hepatitis C Virus Infection on the Safety of Chemotherapy for Breast Cancer Patients. So this is a retrospective chart analysis. Now, before delving into the details of the presentation, I'd like to give a brief overview about clinical research. So we have been talking about, we take medicines every day. Most of us, our parents, our friends, our elders, we are taking medicines, some medicine every day. And nowadays we are talking so much about a COVID vaccine. So from where do all these things come? So these come from a combination of non-clinical research and clinical research. While non-clinical research are the theoretical research and the experimental lab works, which we all do either in test tubes, cell lines, or animal models, in clinical research, the data is provided by a human being. So in that case, the human beings become the guinea pigs. And there are two types of clinical research. They can either be an observational study or a clinical trial. And the names probably explain what these studies do. In an observational research, you're recruiting a group of people and you're studying them over time. You're not providing any intervention. They are leading their life exactly the way they would under any normal circumstances, but yet they're providing you some amount of data to answer your research question. In case of a clinical trial, there is an active intervention which is given to a group of people, and they are compared against a group of people who are either given a different intervention or they are not given any intervention at all. Now, this is a very simple way of explaining what a clinical trial is. Mostly, the clinical trials will have an intervention group and have a control group. The control group will either get an active control or a placebo control, and the studies will either be double-blinded, single-blinded, or with no blinding at all. But as the complexity of the research question increases, the complexity of the clinical trial also increases. And so you can very well imagine finding anything new, presenting anything new to the entire world is a very, very, very challenging thing. And clinical trials typically last many years before the drug or the device that is being studied is approved, or an entire medication regimen is approved to be administered to all people around the globe. Having said that, today I'll be discussing an observational study which had the objective of seeing if hepatitis C has any negative effect on women receiving breast cancer therapy in the form of chemotherapy. So why suddenly hepatitis C and why suddenly breast cancer? Now, hepatitis C is a viral infection which is caused by the hepatitis C virus, which causes an inflammation of the liver. This is a blood-borne disease and spreads when the virus enters the bloodstream of an uninfected person. And there are various ways that a person can become infected, which varies from unclean water sources to using shared needles for drug use. Now, this disease typically has two phases. One is the acute phase, in which the disease usually goes undiagnosed because it rarely has any symptoms and lasts for a time limit of about 2 weeks to 3 months. And almost 30% of the population that gets infected with hepatitis C, the acute phase spontaneously clears off. But in some cases, the disease goes on to the chronic phase, and even the chronic phase can be silent for many years before the virus does enough damage to the liver for the signs and symptoms to show up in the form of liver diseases. Globally, HCV exists in several genotypes, and the most common HCV genotypes that are available that are common in North America are type 1. There is also something called a type 2 genotype, which occurs, but it is relatively less common. Now, HCV is also an oncogenic virus and is associated with several types of cancers, including hepatocarcinoma, which is probably very obvious, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma disease, renal cancer, and prostate cancer. HCV increases the risk 17-fold times. The risk of HCC, that is hepatocellular carcinoma, increases 17-fold times in a person who has an active HCV infection as compared to a person who does not have the infection. According to the latest CDC reports, which was published in 2016, the incidence of HCV was 1 in 100,000. And according to a 2013-2016 National Health and Nutritional Exam survey, 2.4 million people in 2016 had an active HCV infection. As you can appreciate, these numbers are pretty high. So there is a necessity to understand and study a little more about hepatitis C virus. Now, another common disease which affects mainly the female population is breast cancer. So according to a 2015 CDC report, breast cancer is the second most common cancer in women. It is second only to some form of skin cancers and causes the second most cancer-related death in US women. However, the techniques that are present to identify, treat, and treat breast cancer have improved over the decades, and the prognosis of the disease in general has improved. This is because there is increased awareness, increased screening techniques, and also, of course, increased and advanced treatment in the form of either surgery, chemotherapy, hormonal therapy, biological therapy, or radiotherapy. However, the type of treatment that the patient is getting, how well the patient is going to respond to that treatment, depends largely on the type and the stage of the disease diagnosed. Some people, those who get chemotherapy is a very common way of treating breast cancer, and most chemotherapy drugs undergo a hepatic metabolism, and it is a challenge to treat patient with malignancy with pre-existing conditions which affect their liver health. So although breast cancer affects a large number of women in the US, there are no guidelines on how breast cancer patients should be treated if they have a concurrent HCV infection. And the existing literature is divided on whether being HCV positive pose any problem in a patient receiving chemotherapy as treatment for her breast cancer. So that was our research question, where we tried to see if a concurrent HCV infection, if in patients, breast cancer patients with concurrent HCV infection undergoing chemotherapy have a lower tolerance to the treatment and find it more difficult to treatment their regimen. The idea is that if you are suffering from a disease, the best way to cure yourself is to get the treatment in an uninterrupted way and quickly. So if for whatever underlying conditions, in this case, we're talking about HCV, if that affects your treatment, delays your treatment, that means there is something wrong. You need to do something so that you can overcome that delay and give the patient the best fighting chance to deal with this breast cancer. So in this case, we used data from Boston Medical Center. That was where I was working at that point of time. So BMC Cancer Registry provided us with a list of 44 breast cancer patients who had an active HCV infection and were diagnosed and or treated at BMC between January 2000 and April 2015. I went through the medical charts of all these 44 patients. Now in the US, there are certain things which are very good. Like after moving to the US, I've realized that there are certain things which are very good. And one of these are the electronic medical records. So irrespective of where you are, suppose I'm in Boston today, I have an electronic medical record. I do not have my medical files with me. They are all present in an electronic file in the doctor's office that I go to see. So if I move from Boston here today, say to New York, and I go and see a new doctor over there, I just need to tell them that this is the doctor that I was seeing. I need to sign a form that will allow my doctor in New York to approach my doctor in Boston, and all my medical records will be sent to him directly. So this is the electronic medical record. So you do not have to take care of your medical files. When I first came here, this was a really challenging thing for me to accept. I've always been used to taking care of my own things, especially my medical file. That thing changed. But the good thing about this is, no matter in which part of the country you are, forget about moving to New York. Suppose you go on a trip, you meet with an accident over there, and you need to be treated. You are not carrying your medical file with you, but since the electronic medical records are present, they can be transferred over the internet within a matter of few seconds. Anyways, coming back to the presentation, so I went through the electronic medical records of these 44 patients, and it was seen that various people were excluded for the reasons that are mentioned in the second box of this flowchart. And it was seen that there were only 6 patients of these 44 who received chemotherapy treatment for their breast cancers and had documented proof of being HCV positive during their treatment. Now, if you remember, there is something from my first slide, there's something called a case control study. So basically, these 6 people are my cases. And to say that they are actually, that their being HCV positive affects or does not affect, since we do not know the answer of that question yet, their treatment, we have to compare them with a group of matched controls. The only difference between these two groups would be that the first group, which has 6 people, are HCV positive. And the second group, since we are doing a 2:1 matched control with 12 people, will be exactly the same, except that they'll have their HCV, they will not be infected with HCV virus. So my total study population becomes 16 with 6 cases and 12 matched controls. Now, the outcome variables or the question that we were looking at or the questions that we were asking is there a delay in chemotherapy between these two groups? Is there a dose change? So chemotherapy is given in various doses, and depending on how well a person is taking that chemotherapy, if you're not really coping up with the chemotherapy very well, then your doses will be changed. There are instances in which not only the dose, but the entire regimen has to be changed because the treatment does not suit the participant. So these were the questions which we were asking. Is there a difference between the two groups? Were there delays in chemotherapies? Were there dose changes in chemotherapy? Were the side effects of chemotherapy so bad that the patient had to be hospitalized for any reason? And if so, for how long? Were there any hematologic reasons for dose delay? So after every chemotherapy session, a patient needs to come back in about 5 or 7 days to get their blood tested to see how they are coping with the chemotherapy that is being provided. It's typically the white blood cell count which are collected. And if the count of the WBC is below a threshold, then there may be a dose delay, because that means that your body is not coping well with the chemotherapy, and it would be wrong to provide you with a second dose or a third dose or the nth dose of chemotherapy at say 7 days or 14 days after the first dose or the previous dose that was given. We also wanted to see whether there was any variation in WBC and ANC in the patients during the chemotherapy cycles. So this first table basically shows how well the two groups, that is the cases group and the control groups, compared against one another. In terms of age, they were pretty similar. Obviously, since we're talking about breast cancer, all the patients in this case were females. There were some differences between their race, their tobacco use, their alcohol use, and substance use between the two groups. The cases group was obviously all HCV positives, the negative control, and the controls were all negative. We also matched them on the stage of cancer, and this shows that we did that perfectly correct. In terms of histology, all the cases that we investigated had invasive ductal carcinoma. The immunohistochemistry of the cases were slightly different in the two groups. And since we matched them on the chemotherapy regimen, they were pretty similar. Like 5 people in the cases group got ACT regimen as compared, and for a 2:2 match control, 10 people got the ACT regimen in the control group. And the one remaining participant got a TC regimen. And so we had two patients in the control group who got the TC regimen. So among these groups, among the six people, those who were in the cases, only one person had interferon treatment for 11 months, which ended almost 5 years before this person had her cancer diagnosis. And the patient responded to that interferon treatment. The interferon treatment is basically a way to treat HCV. The patient responded to that treatment, but reverted back, did not have a sustained virologic relief, and went back to being HCV positive at the time that she was diagnosed with the cancer. Now, moving on to the results, this chart shows what happened over the course of their chemotherapy treatment. So in the cases group, all the six patients had a dose delay. The dose delay was for hematologic reasons in 5 cases and for non-hematologic reasons in 1 case. And 4 of the 6 participants had a dose delay or had a dose change. If we look in contrast to the HCV negative group, only 4 patients had a dose delay, and 1 was due to hematologic reason and 3 were due to non-hematologic reason. And there was dose change in only 1 of those participants. So these numbers show that there is something different going on between these two groups. But for any clinical research study, just showing numbers really does not signify anything. You need to show that there is a statistical difference between the two arms or not to prove or disprove whatever you're trying to prove. And for our case, we did statistical analysis and we said at the start of our paper that we'll say that there's a statistical difference between the two groups if these groups vary by a p-value of less than 0.05. Now, this table shows that the p-value was less than 0.05 for dose delay, dose change, hospitalization, and hematologic dose delay between the two groups, which means that the cases and the controls, that is the people, those who were HCV positive and HCV negative, were distinctly different and responded differently to the chemotherapy treatment. The HCV positive group was faring worse. They had greater dose delays, they had greater dose change, they had greater hospitalization, they had greater hematologic dose delays as compared to their HCV negative counterparts. So basically, they were taking the treatment poorly than the HCV negative counterparts. We also did a comparison to see what was the variation of WBC and ANC between the two groups. And as you can understand from the p-values, there was not much difference between the WBC and the ANC variation during the course of the treatment. This chart shows how the WBC varied between the cases and the control. So each graph over here represents one case and its corresponding two controls. And as can be seen, most of the cases had a prolonged treatment duration. I have a similar graph for ANC, but I'm not putting it up because it essentially implies and shows the same thing. So our results showed that HCV positive patients have higher dose delays, higher dose modifications, higher hospitalization rates, and higher hematologic dose delays. The decrease in blood count post the chemotherapy 1 cycle and post NADID is similar in both groups. And we also showed that the HCV positive participants had a longer chemotherapy duration than the HCV negative patients. So what does this essentially mean? It essentially means that you have two groups of people, one who is HCV positive, one who is HCV negative. They are getting the same chemotherapy. They are having a same underlying condition of breast cancer, but the HCV positive group is dealing with more troubles during their treatment for their breast cancer than the HCV negative group. The good thing, there are treatments available which can treat HCV today. 10 years back, the story was completely different. But today, there are direct acting antivirals available which can treat an HCV infection. It has been shown that giving in HIV patients, in cancer patients having HIV, a combination therapy with heart and treatment of HIV for treating the HIV and a treatment to treat their cancer is possible. And these patients, like the HIV positive patients who are getting both heart and treatment for their cancer, they are doing much better. They have as compared to people, those who are only getting cancer treatments for their cancer but are not being treated for their HIV. So these people can deal with the problems of chemotherapy or the cancer treatment much better. So given that we have direct acting antivirals, DAAs, present in today's world, it is probably worth seeing if a co-treatment or a concurrent treatment in HCV positive patients with DAAs and chemotherapy improves the way these people respond to or cope with the chemotherapy and give them their best fighting chance. Now, all clinical studies have certain strengths and certain limitations, and this study is no exception. The strengths of this study was they used matched controls, and even though we had such a small sample size, the conclusions were very overwhelming that the two groups, HCV positive and HCV negative groups, responded very differently to the chemotherapy that was being given to them. In terms of limitation, most of these limitations are a part of the study design. This is a retrospective study, and we had no control over what was happening because the incidents had already happened. The study size was small, and it was based out of a single study site, which makes generalization of these results difficult. So going forward, it would be nice to see the same results or similar results in a multi-cohort study, and also maybe do a clinical trial in a clinical trial setting to see what happens to participants if they are given HCV, DAAs and chemotherapy concurrently. These are the people I'd like to acknowledge. All of them had been phenomenal support for carrying out this research. And lastly, I'd like to thank you all, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Shobda Ponnadi, for such a informative and lucid presentation. Not being into clinical research, I too could decode your observations and could understand what you tried to convey. So thanks a lot for sharing your valuable time. So let's take for the question. So let's take for the questions. Okay, one question I'm finding, it's from Mr. Porimal Pramanik. He's saying, what's the main basic difference between hepatitis A, B, and C?
Unfortunately, I don't have an answer for that. I'm not a medical doctor. My research was just on hepatitis C, and unfortunately, I don't have an answer for that. But as far as I remember, it's the method in which the virus acts, and also the way one can get infected. Like hepatitis C virus infects in a very different way than hepatitis A virus.
Okay, thank you. And then there are many appreciations as I can find from in the chat box. So I also thank on behalf of Dr. Shobda Ponnadi Ghosh to all the audience for their appreciation. And I have another comment from Dr. Debaruti Guho. She said that I think our India government is also tried to do a similar electronic medical file for us.
That's really something which should be supported. I know my parents are doctors. So whenever I tell them about electronic medical records, they get a little worried about handling a computer. Like are we going to see patients or are we going to see like typing out things on a computer? Well, here the doctors, they do the typing out themselves, but in India, you can actually, that may be actually a very good job, like somebody who is tech savvy can just do that job of writing it down. You'll have to figure it out. Each country figures its own way out.
Exactly, sure. Another question I have, it says, it's from Dr. Shomojit Chakraborty. How did you find the p-value, t-test with equal variance or unequal variance?
Equal variances.
Okay, that answers the questions. And I see there are appreciations, no more questions. So I thank Saptapurnidhi once more for being with us, sharing your valuable time. And we would request you to share your research in future also with us. So thank you, Saptapurnidhi.
And now I
request Dr. Sonali Mukhopadhyay, Head Department of Economics, to proceed with the session. Sonali Di, please.
Thank you, Dr. Saptapurnidhi Ghosh, for selecting such a nice topic, and mainly our college is a girls' college. Thank you for such a nice presentation. Now, before requesting Dr. Kothakoli Chatterjee for her oral representation, I want to give a short notice. We will provide a feedback form at the end of this session. I request you all to fill up the forms correctly, as the certificate will be provided according to those informations and no corrections will be allowed once the certificate is issued. Now, may I request Dr. Kothakoli Chatterjee? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, can I present the screen?
Yes, of course. Atri, can you help her?
Is my screen audible?
Yes. Yes,
okay, a hearty good afternoon to everyone. Today I'm the paper presenter. My paper is Identifying Crisis of Sustainability During COVID-19. It's a twin paper we have with my husband. Now, basically,
once again, excuse me, Kothakoli.
Yes,
Atri,
yes.
Is it visible? Atri?
Ma'am, only your screen is visible.
Yeah, yes, I think Dr. Ghosh has stopped her presenting, no?
Oh, maybe, yeah. Yes, that's why I cannot share my screen.
Yes, I think so.
Ma'am, please represent once.
Okay.
So I think I have stopped it because it's just showing present now.
Resume your presentation.
Ma'am, please minimize the sharing screen and maximize your PowerPoint session.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. Sorry for the disturbance. Okay. My topic is Identifying Crisis of Sustainability During COVID-19. Now, we know what is sustainability. We already have an idea that is something or doing or rather investing something so that our future generation might expect from it. We must understand that human beings always prefer to live in groups. However, with the passage of time, family bonds, the cohesion, that is attraction between people, familyhood, these things have grown up in a very much fashionable way. Now, what is pandemic and society? Let us first analyze that what is a society? The aggregate of people living together in a more or less ordered community. You say the word aggregate and community has been highlighted, but during the COVID time, a cross is being seen here. So do you think that these two words have got significance during the COVID time? Actually, aggregate and community means a sense of togetherness, which we are not finding in the time of COVID, a common entity, we are not finding in the time of COVID, a comprehensive attachment, nothing of this sort. Now, we have seen inequality as the time passes away in every aspect, in economic, cultural, educational, psychological, physiological. We already know that there is a difference between have and have-nots. Specifically during this COVID time, these things have become very much more prominent. What exactly is the scenario of modern society during this COVID-19? Now, obviously, we have seen a great social setback that is cry for food, shelter, jobs, and it has left thousands of people in a dilapidated condition. The fear of being contaminated has even made distance between the near ones. And with the speculation of losing jobs, people are frustrated and obviously helpless. So at this time, if I talk about resource utilization, social security, or sustainability, it is nothing more than a mockery. Sustainability at this moment, are you crazy? No. Since the time of announcement of first lockdown, society has started showing a very peculiar experience. It has depicted a special kind of behavior which the world has never viewed before. The lockdown has made the people to forget the life, the essence of being a social being, a human being, its values, and even the potentialities of sustainability. They are running to gather the essential items, stocking 50 kgs of rice, wheat, and flour as a single household. Those who have money, they're going on stocking this, accumulating the daily necessities of whatever is required, piling up more and more medicines, and the trend is still continuing. Have you ever the cry for baby food? There is a continuous urge of getting more and more packets of Nanpro and Nestle products so that your baby can get in a proper manner during the, or rather can get food during this lockdown time. Stocking of life-saving medicines, maybe when we are buying one strip of medicine which would be useful for us, we are going on buying in thousands, or rather in hundreds. And the shops are also coping up in this kind of business. So this is not at all a society which is desirable in a sustainable mode. Now, the actual scenario is obviously quite different. There's a million-dollar question that when even after repeated assurance from the part of the government, both from central and the state, people have engaged themselves in collecting their daily survival requirements. Now, how we can relate pandemic and social sustainability? I have made a primary survey through Google Forms among 50 respondents, and I came out with very exclusive answers. An overwhelming response. What I found is that 86% of the respondents have agreed that they are aware of the concept of sustainability. Everybody knows it. Believe in the use of sustainable resource, obviously, but honestly declared that sustainability cannot be followed particularly in this time. Nije bacho, oporke baste dao. No. Nije bacho, nije khao. Let me leave, then I will let other leave. Pandemic and achievement of social sustainability have got various behavioral analysis. The changes has come in individual level behavior, in the multi-level behavior, in the mental health problems have coped up, social influence models have fell down, multiple societal sectors have been gone down. So it's a huge crisis up in the modern world. Now, there is a misnomer in understanding what COVID-19 wants is the physical distancing, but now people have started social distancing. It has never said to distance socially from one people to another, but what we require is physical distancing. But now these two words are being used in just like two sides of a coin. Now, there are various obstacles to sustainability, as I was telling about poverty, agony, and fear, the knowledge about the diseases, role of social media. Now, these things have come up in a both positive and negative manner. Particularly at this juncture, societal well-being eventually relates to human happiness or the capacity of individuals to realize the perception of a good life. But no one can say that in this pandemic period, anyone is experiencing a very good phenomena or a positive vibration, because they are being affected both by physiological and sociological effect. A sustainable society is definitely a one. If you look at the definition, it's something that is being established by ecological limits, and definitely it has ecological, economic, and self-satisfaction. That is, I think, the most important part, that you are self-satisfied from your part. If you are self-satisfied, then only you can discover, or rather you can share your values in the part of ecological and economical environment. David Smith in 1973 has given out various indicators of what a person needs to be in a self-sustainable mood, that is income and wealth, employment, health, education. But if you look at this, all these sectors have, especially during the COVID period, these sectors have influenced a great setback in this time, which itself is a kind of a very negative vibration from the part of the people. Loss of jobs, end of life, it's a very common picture. The untold stories, depression, anxiety, fear of facing family members. The people who are losing jobs, they are in a fear to face the family members, fear of feeding their own children. So these are the things that are continuing in this period. However, we must understand that all this, though there are mental anxiety, though there is loss of employment opportunities, but we have to provide, or we have to emphasize on physical wellness, emotional wellness, this we can do at any time. Intellectual wellness, financial wellness, social wellness, all these do not require any monetary terms. Occupational wellness, environmental wellness, cultural wellness, and obviously spiritual wellness. This is something which is inherent within one person. Now, health is wealth. You have heard this thing, or wealth is health. It has turned out in a new manner in this COVID-19 period. Now, from my survey, I have also found that merely 3% of my respondents have agreed to help people who is suffering from coronavirus. This is actually the true picture of society now. About 94% of the respondents have shown anxiety in response to their own health and health of their family members. About 95% of the respondents are under confident with the current infection control measures. Any health issues, particularly of any kind, has made 87% of the person or people to be mentally unfit. A typical fear of COVID-19 is coming up, or rather it's in the mind of every people. 87% of the people think that they are asymptomatic carriers of COVID-19. 98% of people think that they will be attacked by corona in future. About 99% of the people believe that if they're attacked by corona, then they will not survive, or they do not have that money to spend on the treatment. About 78% of the people do not possess a very clear idea that what is actually a quarantine is. About 65% of the people do not know the proper way of using a face mask. 70% of the common men from well-to-do family believed in the use of N95 mask, but they don't know what is its consequence. A typical hand sanitizer revolution has definitely came up in this time. Now, what we require is exactly the social and mental peace. A society should be a common area. It was obvious the previous concept where people always lend their hand for any kind of support. But this concept has changed, and now society has become infectious, that when people are lending their hand, they're thinking whether my hand will be sanitized or not, whether in my hand there will be corona or not. So they're not at all lending their hand, but they're not encouraging none of its members apart from its own circle. Now, this is the Sustainable Society Index, like human well-being, environmental well-being, and economic well-being, which I've already discussed, but I have highlighted few parts which we can gain, or we can make sustainable even in this corona period or COVID period, that is sufficient food, sufficient to drink, and safe sanitation, education, healthy life, gender equality, income distribution, population growth, good governance, and a negative effect can be analyzed on the GDP, employment, and public debt. Now, how to combat this pandemic with a dream of sustainable society? We have to overcome the fear. We have to avoid the social media for a few days. You know, if you go on looking at the news, this much of people are getting affected each day, and this much of people are getting not getting in the hospitals and all, you will develop a COVID, a mental COVID in your head. That is to control one's emotion. You also need to control very much. You need not be very much emotional that what will happen with lot of news. There are a lot of news. People are dying without getting admitted in the hospital. All this create a lot of impact on your mental consciousness. You have to be suit off from this kind of anticipation. You should not anticipate. You are well. You stay well. You must empathize, you must define. Empathize means you need to understand what is exactly going on. You should have a clear definition of what is going on. ideate. You have to provide idea of your own. Prototype. You should not be thinking that what has happened to them will be happening to us. And at last, it should be tested. You should validate yourself that the decisions that you have made, it is acceptable to everyone or not. I hope this sustainable society will be prevailing in the COVID-19 period. And thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kothaburli Chatterjee, for your nice presentation and showing us the about the future sustainable society. Now may I request Ms. Atri Bhattacharya and Ms. Pooja Dash to display the digital presentations of our participants. Hello, Atri.
Yes.
Okay, thank
ma'am,
you.
Ma'am, we are presenting.
Okay, thank you.
Hello to everyone that's viewing this video. So this paper is a research into what factors affect the mutual fund industry. The mutual fund industry, as we all know, is a very undertapped industry, specifically in an under. Hello to everyone that's viewing this video. So this paper is a research into what factors affect the mutual fund industry. The mutual fund industry, as we all know, is a very undertapped industry, specifically in an underdeveloped country such as India. People don't have enough funds to invest, and even if they have enough funds to invest, they don't have the correct avenues to invest. And even if they have correct avenues, they don't know the procedure, or the rate of return provided is not enough. As we all know, in this time which has been shut down by COVID, even the banks have started reducing their savings bank account interest, which is a major source of income for a lot of households, and which is the only avenue of investment which is known to multitudes, I would like to say more than 60% of the investors in India. I'm pretty sure most of the investors don't even know what a mutual fund exactly is or how a mutual fund exactly works. So this is a study into one of the major contributors into the household sector. The household sector savings in India have been on a rise since the inception of different avenues of investments in the financial sector. Since the onset, the mutual fund industry has faced a lot of challenges such as lack of investor awareness, incomplete information, perceptions of the investor regarding the inability of mutual funds to cater to their needs. So the objectives of the study would be to identify the factors influencing the investment decisions in mutual funds, to identify the dominant factors that induce an investor to invest in such avenues such as mutual funds, to analyze the investment decisions based on demographic characteristics, to analyze the perception of people towards alternative form of investments, to suggest measures of consideration for the fund managers before venturing or launching new products. Now, as we know, there are a lot of players into the mutual fund industry as of today. We have the HDFC mutual funds from the private sector, and we have the SBI mutual funds managed by the government. So the fund managers are always launching new products, even every quarter, I would like to say, differing on the needs of the people. COVID times have given a rise to a lot of mutual fund products that will be needed by the people in the future. And specifically, owing to the falling rates of the savings bank, mutual funds would definitely prove to be a potent avenue. So the methodology used by me to verify as to the factors that affect the investments is an empirical probe into the major determinants of the mutual fund industry. Factor analysis had been run on the data collected, and the data had been collected through primary source. There was a questionnaire circulated, and there were a total of 105 respondents. The purpose of the study was to understand the viewpoint and preferences of the respondents towards the mutual funds. So basically, I reviewed literatures as well, and some of them are by Mr. Akriju Sanju and K. Bhavna Raj in the article Performance and Persistence of the Mutual Fund Industry, followed by an article by Bilal Ahmed Pando, which goes by the title Performance of Mutual Funds in India. Next, we have Arthi Biswas and Ian Iyer, followed by Anju S. Parvita NR. In that article, a study on factors affecting investments on mutual funds and its preferences to retail investors. Then we have a paper by Eric C. Chang, Wilbur G. Levinlin, in the named Market Timing and Mutual Fund Investment Performances. Then we have a paper by Professor Naina Iqbal, which talked about the challenges and issues faced by the Indian mutual fund industry, followed by a paper by Rajesh Chakraborty, Sarath Malik, Sudhakar Panatkar, and Aadhar Verma, in the, which went by the name Penetration of Mutual Funds in India, Opportunities and Challenges Faced by Them. Then we have a paper by Mrs. S. Nilima and Dr. D. Surya Chandra Rao, which also talked about the factors influencing investments in mutual fund selections. So basically, as we all know, mutual funds are basically an unit comprising of different stocks that are basically out of the reach of the affordability of a normal person or a normal investor, as to say. It gives them ample liquidity and an opportunity to have access to those sources of income that is accessed by the rich and privileged in today's society. So basically, the conclusion that was reached after the empirical study and running a factor analysis on all the responses, the following conclusions were reached. Analyzing the first component, awareness about mutual fund schemes and their associated tax benefits, it is noted that individuals have information available about these schemes probably since asset management companies have high disclosure requirements and tax benefits form a major proportion of such components, and hence hedge funds should disclose such specifications adequately. This component can be known as awareness about mutual fund schemes and their associated tax benefits. Next, the second component would be knowledge about alternative investments. If a person is very well known to the alternate investments, to their merits and demerits, definitely that will affect their investments on the mutual fund sector. If they are finding high advantages at very high rates in different sectors, definitely they won't be investing here, which also where an industry also has risks due to the stock market, as we all know. So information about different alternative investments is a very major factor. Third, and one of the most major components that we can see, are the preference with regard to professional management of portfolio. Even if investors have the funds and the means to invest in the stock market, they don't have the expertise. So mutual funds provide them with managers with specialized knowledge in managing their portfolio. So even if they do not earn an adequate return, it won't be due to their lack of knowledge. They'll have a professional handle their portfolio, and it rarely happens that they do not get adequate returns. And the lastly, the risk sensitivity of the investor. An investor who's highly risk averse won't opt for it, and vice versa. Thank you, Dachin.
A warm welcome to everyone. My name is Chirag Bhansali, and today I'm going to present my topic, Empirical Investigation into the Impact of Behavioral Biases on an Individual's Financial Decisions. We believe that behavioral finance is a much wider topic and includes emotional, behavioral, and psychological aspects along with the theories of traditional finance. Those theories, such as modern portfolio theory and utility theory, are based on the assumptions of a rational economic man and also assume that information is perfectly available in the markets, which are efficient. But in reality, individual investors have limited information and knowledge, which is described by the term bounded rationality. Traditional theories also provide a rule-based or prescribed solutions, which makes it quite rigid for the dynamic environment in which we live. So expected utility theory is one of those traditional theories. This theory is based on the assumption of rationality. What this tries to explain is that when an individual is given a set of choices or opportunities, he will choose that opportunity or that choice which provides him the maximum benefit or maximum utility. But obviously this theory is limited, since individuals do not always make rational choices. This theory was challenged by prospect theory with the help of loss aversion bias. Loss aversion bias means that an individual has asymmetrical behavior towards a gain or loss. So what this theory stated is that for different individuals having different attributes, their choices will be different.
Hello.
So in this paper, we take into account 12 major biases. First one is loss aversion bias, which means individuals having asymmetrical reaction towards gains or losses. Second is recency bias, which means focusing more on recent events to predict future outcomes. Third is house money effect, which means individuals invest their investment gains or incomes into more risky opportunities. Fourth is hindsight bias, which means believing that we know the result of any future event and we try to forget our past mistakes or errors and overestimate our abilities. Next is overconfidence bias, which has a similar meaning. It means overestimating the ability of reasoning or decision making. Anchoring bias involves putting too much weight on the initial reference point, also known as the anchor. Gambler's fallacy involves wrong estimation of probabilities. Herding bias involves copying actions of others, for example, copying the trades of an investment expert. Endowment effect involves overestimating personal assets. Confirmation bias involves a biased behavior towards own research and ignoring or not accepting criticism. Risk aversion bias implies risk is directly proportional to returns. Status quo bias shows the reactive attitude of individuals towards changes. Objective of this paper is to determine how these 12 biases individually influence decision making and what is their overall impact towards investment decisions. Main limitation of this paper is quantification of qualitative information such as behaviors and emotions of individuals, and hence statistical tools do not provide accurate information. Also, there are many other factors and biases which have not been accounted for to reduce the complexity of this paper. So what we have done is we have distributed questionnaires to various individuals and have recorded their responses. Their responses, which have different opinions, are represented with the help of bar graphs for further analysis. Then we have tried to determine the influence of each particular bias individually. For both loss aversion bias and recency bias, majority of the respondents have agreed to be influenced by this bias, and very few have stated that they are free from this bias. Same goes for house money effect and hindsight bias. Analysis shows that these biases have a significant influence among the sample. In case of overconfidence bias, very few number of respondents have agreed to be influenced by this bias, whereas for anchoring bias, majority of responses have been in agreement. For gambler's fallacy, majority of the respondents have reacted in agreement, whereas for herding bias, people don't seem to relate with this bias. More different opinions and increased confidence can be a reason for this. For all the remaining biases, be it endowment effect, confirmation bias, risk aversion or status quo, majority of the responses have agreed that they are influenced with this bias, and all these biases show their significant presence in the sample. We can conclude by saying that loss aversion bias and risk aversion bias are interlinked. Individuals having a greater degree of loss aversion will be more risk averse. Our analysis has also shown that a fair number of respondents have agreed to be influenced by both these biases. Recency bias, hindsight bias, overconfidence bias, and confirmation bias are closely related, and all these are dependent on the attitude and temperament of individuals. Anchoring bias and gambler's fallacy are interlinked. For example, a gambler thinks that the same number won't appear twice. Although the probability of that number appearing again remains same, in this situation, the anchor point is the first occurrence of that number. Less influence of herding bias shows people are getting more confident, and more influence of status quo bias shows that people are very reluctant towards changes. Finally, this paper suggests that traditional theories are rigid and should include factors such as behavior, emotions, and psychology of individuals so that these theories and models can predict future outcomes in a better way.
Hello, I'm Raj Rajeshwar Sharma, and today I'll be discussing our paper, Flying High, Valuation and IPO Analysis of Unicorns. Unicorns are private companies which are valued over $1 billion and currently 465 such companies exist. These are generally technology startups which are market disruptors functioning in already existing markets. In literature review, we aim to understand the pre-IPO valuation. A paper suggests that discounted cash flow is inaccurate, but comparable firms multiple is accurate if proper forecasting is used. While another paper suggests that a final fair value is calculated by incorporating all these models, but a deliberate discount is applied, thereby showcasing underpricing. Apart from underpricing, IPO overvaluation is also observed, which is the result of underwriter incorporating aggressive marketing strategies to increase demand, and they are also overly positive when forecasting. There are two main objectives of this paper. First, to understand the valuation strategy of the unicorn company Airbnb and discussing the current issues related to it. Second is to analyze the IPO performance of selected companies and thereby discussing the IPO trend. All acronym is formed by Pinterest, Airbnb, Uber, and Lyft that club together as they're all technology startups with high growth. The study uses DCF model to value Airbnb using the free cash flow to the firm multiple. A two-stage model is also applied. As Airbnb is private, we do not get much data, so we use a top-down valuation method. It involves starting from choosing a proper market and the market share for Airbnb and going down to calculate the SCFF. Revenue, EBIT and all other multiples are forecasted in line with the overall market size. Then, FCFF is calculated using the given formula, and then it is also automatically forecasted in line with the market size. The FCFF is then discounted at the cost of capital to calculate the final value of equity. Looking at the assumptions, we forecast the market size to grow in lines with the online travel market at 11.5% for 10 years and then at the risk-free rate of 2.83% till perpetuity. Market share and operating margin move according to the peer and industry averages. Cost of capital is calculated using the weighted average cost of capital formula along with a liquidity premium. Terminal value is calculated after 10 years and discounted. The FCFFs are also discounted and is added up with the discounted terminal value to get the value of operating assets. A probability of failure at 5% is applied, and after adjusting for the cash and debt, we get the value of equity for Airbnb at $36.54 billion. External complications of 2020 makes it difficult to value Airbnb. The global pandemic has reduced the Airbnb's revenue forecast, and our valuation model cannot incorporate such unprecedented events. Airbnb dropped its internal valuation from $31 billion to $18 billion after it took a $2 billion debt funding. Increased regulation and continuous legal wars further complicate the valuation process for Airbnb. These points cast a shadow over Airbnb's IPO plans of 2020. Moving on to our second part, we discuss the IPO performance of three biggest unicorn companies that are Pinterest, Lyft, and Uber. Pinterest intentionally decreased its its internal valuation and thus received a moderate IPO pop, and also its stock price consistently traded above its IPO price post its IPO. It also posted second quarter results which were good. Despite of the IPO pop it received, Lyft was considered heavily overvalued and its stock price plunged after its IPO. It also posted a heavy net loss of 189% in financial year 2019. Uber performed the worst as it opened below its offer price on the IPO date and consistently traded below its IPO price as seen in the chart. It was also considered heavily overvalued. Looking forward, even though we see an increasing trend in the unicorn IPOs, there are many dark clouds surrounding it. Private market continue to overvalue the unicorns who lack financial competence, and public markets are not rewarding it, thereby leading to the IPO failures. WeWork's failed IPO is one of the examples of overvaluation and mistrust by the public market. Unicorn IPOs lost nearly $44 billion in 2019 in market capitalization. After already being on shaky grounds in 2019, unicorns might continue to suffer in 2020 amidst the global pandemic. Unicorn IPO dynamics are changing and the upward trend may not continue. Public market is rebelling against the overvaluation of non-profitable unicorns by the private equity firms and the IPO underwriters. This pessimism towards unicorn IPOs, along with the global pandemic and negative signs for Airbnb, which had IPO plans for 2020. Thank you.
করোনা ভাইরাস হলো এমন একটি সংক্রামক ভাইরাস যা এর আগে কখনো মানুষের মধ্যে ছড়ায়নি। এই ভাইরাসটির আরেক নাম 2019 NCOV বা নোভেল করোনা ভাইরাস। মানুষের ফুসফুসে মারাত্মক রোগ সৃষ্টিকারী এই ভাইরাস চীন থেকে ছড়িয়ে পড়েছে বিশ্বের বেশিরভাগ দেশে। এই ভাইরাসে বিশ্বব্যাপী প্রাণহানি হয়েছে 6 লাখের মতো এবং আক্রান্তের সংখ্যা দাঁড়িয়েছে 1,40,00,000। কোভিড-19 এই অতিমারিটি ভারতে প্রথম শুরু হয় 30 জানুয়ারি 2020 সালে। তার ফলে বহু শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠান এবং বাণিজ্যিক প্রতিষ্ঠান বন্ধ করে দেওয়া হয়। বেশিরভাগ ক্ষেত্রে এই সংক্রমণ নিশ্চিত হওয়ায় অন্যান্য দেশের সাথে সংযুক্ত থাকায় ভারত তো সমস্ত পর্যটন ভিসা স্থগিত রেখেছে। আমাদের দেশের প্রধানমন্ত্রী নরেন্দ্র মোদীর নেতৃত্বে 25 মার্চ 21 দিনের জন্য দেশব্যাপী লকডাউনের নির্দেশ দেওয়া হয়েছিল, আর এর ফলে বিভিন্ন পরিযায়ী শ্রমিক কাজ হারিয়ে তাদের দেশে চলে আসতে শুরু করে। অর্থনীতির মন্দা এখান থেকেই শুরু হয়। রপ্তানি আয় ও রাজস্ব আদায়ের লক্ষ্যমাত্রা অর্জন অনেকটাই অনিশ্চিত হয়ে পড়েছে। চীন থেকে আমদানি প্রায় বন্ধ হওয়ায় ব্যাহত হচ্ছে পোশাক তৈরি সহ পণ্য উৎপাদন। পোশাক ব্যবসায়ীদের জন্য মরার ওপর খাড়ার ঘা হিসেবে এসেছে এই করোনা ভাইরাস। শুধু পোশাক খাতেই নয়, করোনা ছোবল পড়েছে উৎপাদনমুখী প্রায় সব শিল্পে। আমদানি রপ্তানি কমে যাওয়ায় কমে গেছে সরকারের রাজস্ব আদায়। করোনা ভাইরাসের প্রভাবে কমেছে বৈশ্বিক বাজার চাহিদা, আর বৈশ্বিক অর্থনীতির স্বাস্থ্য যদি খারাপ হয় তখন স্বাভাবিকভাবেই সেই সংক্রমণ দেশীয় অর্থনীতির স্বাস্থ্যকে প্রভাবিত করবে। পরিস্থিতি আরও জটিল হবে যদি অভ্যন্তরীণ বাজার চাহিদা কমে যায়, তাই নিত্য প্রয়োজনীয় পণ্যের দামও বাড়ছে লাগামহীনভাবে। করোনা থেকে বাঁচতে আগাম যেসব ব্যবস্থা করা হচ্ছে তাতে থমকে যাচ্ছে অর্থনীতি, তাই আতঙ্ক নয়, সচেতনভাবে মোকাবিলা করতে হবে এই সংকটময় পরিস্থিতিকে। সচল রাখতে হবে অভ্যন্তরীণ বাজার পরিস্থিতি, তবেই করোনা ধকল কাটাতে পারে দেশীয় অর্থনীতি। করোনা মহামারীর প্রভাবে বিপর্যস্ত অর্থনীতিকে টেনে তুলতে এবং উদ্যোক্তাদের ঘুরে দাঁড়াতে লক্ষ কোটি টাকা প্রণোদনা প্যাকেজের সুষ্ঠু বাস্তবায়নের তাগিদ দিয়েছেন বিশেষজ্ঞরা। করোনা ভাইরাস তথা কোভিড-19 প্রভাবে ভারতে অর্থনীতির অবস্থা খুবই সংকটজনক। দীর্ঘদিনের লকডাউনের ফলে ভারতের ইকোনমি পুরো স্তব্ধ হয়ে রয়েছে। করোনা ভাইরাসের প্রভাবে ভারতীয় অর্থনীতি বিরাট সংকটে পড়েছে জানালো বিশ্বব্যাংক। আগে থেকে যে সংকটগুলি ছিল সেগুলি আরও ব্যাপক চেহারায় দেখা দিচ্ছে। করোনার প্রকোপে সমগ্র দক্ষিণ এশিয়ায় অর্থনীতির ওপর কি প্রভাব পড়েছে সে সম্পর্কে জানাতে গিয়ে বিশ্বব্যাংক আন্দাজ করেছে ভারতের অর্থনৈতিক গতি 5% হ্রাস পেতে পারে 2020 এবং 2021 অর্থবর্ষে 2.8% বৃদ্ধি হ্রাসেরও আশঙ্কাও করছে তারা। করোনা মহামারীর ফলে বিপর্যস্ত অর্থনীতিকে টেনে তুলতে দেশের কৃষি শিল্প সহ সামগ্রিক আর্থিক খাতের পুনরুদ্ধারে কার্যকর উদ্যোগ নিতে হবে। এই জন্য বিনিয়োগ ও কর্মসংস্থানকে অধিক গুরুত্ব দিয়ে আসছে অর্থনীতি বিশ্লেষকরা। একই সাথে রপ্তানি ও সোমবাজারের দিকেও গভীর মনোযোগ দেওয়ার পরামর্শ দিচ্ছেন বিশেষজ্ঞরা। করোনা ভাইরাস বিস্তার ঠেকাতে জারি করা হয়েছে লকডাউন, বিশ্বের বেশিরভাগ দেশ থেকেই ধীরে ধীরে তুলে নেওয়া হচ্ছে যাতে দেশগুলির অর্থনীতির আবার স্বাভাবিক গতিতে চলতে পারে। তবে এটা আশা করা হচ্ছে যে দোকানপাট ও ব্যবসা প্রতিষ্ঠান ধীরে ধীরে খুলে দেওয়ায় আস্তে আস্তে পরিস্থিতি ঠিক হতে শুরু করবে।
শ্রদ্ধেয়া মহাশয়া, আমি দেবারতী চন্দ, আমি থার্ড সেমিস্টার সেকেন্ড ইয়ারের জিওগ্রাফি অনার্সের ছাত্রী। আজকে আমার বক্তব্যের মূল বিষয় হল কোভিড-19 প্রভাবে সমাজের ওপর অর্থনৈতিক অবস্থা। বিশ্বে এই কোভিড-19 মহামারী আকারে ছড়িয়ে পড়ায় নানানভাবে মানুষ জীবনের ক্ষতি হয়েছে। এই মহামারীর ফলসহ সমাজের অপূরণীয় ক্ষতিও হয়েছে। এছাড়া কোভিড-19 ভীষণভাবে বিশ্বব্যাপী অর্থনীতিকে অব্যাহত করেছে। যাতে আরও এই রোগ সংক্রমণ সীমাবদ্ধ হয়, এই সমাজে বহু কোভিড-19 আক্রান্ত দেশ পুরোপুরি লকডাউনের মধ্যে দিয়ে যাওয়ার সিদ্ধান্ত নিয়েছে। বড় বড় আন্তর্জাতিক বিমান এবং সব ধরনের ব্যবসা পরিবহন বিলম্বিত করা হয়েছে। বিভিন্ন দেশের মধ্যে এই লকডাউনের জন্য সব দেশীয় উড়ান, রেলপথ পরিষেবা, মালগাড়ি বাদে বাস, ট্রাম, যানবাহন স্থগিত রয়েছে। বিশেষ ছাড় শুধু প্রয়োজনীয় পণ্যগুলির সাথে জড়িত। প্রায় সব কোভিড-19 পীড়িত দেশগুলিতে সব শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠান, ক্রীড়া প্রতিষ্ঠান এবং আধ্যাত্মিক প্রতিষ্ঠান বন্ধ আছে। শিল্পগুলি ক্ষতিগ্রস্ত হয়ে পড়েছে ভীষণভাবে। এদের মধ্যে প্রয়োজনীয় সুযোগ সুবিধাযুক্ত শিল্পগুলি বাদে বিভিন্ন দেশগুলিতে বেশিরভাগ শিল্পগুলি বন্ধ রাখা হয়েছে। সেই সব লোকজন যারা সব যুক্ত রয়েছে পর্যটন এবং পরিবহন শিল্প কেন্দ্রে, তারাও পরম অসুবিধার মুখোমুখি হয়ে পড়েছে। উৎপাদন স্তর খুব নিচে চলে গেছে। কিছু তথাকথিত ক্ষমতাশীল দেশগুলির অর্থনীতি এখন মুখোমুখি হয়ে পড়েছে বিভিন্ন উচ্চ মূল্যস্ফীত ভয় প্রদর্শনে এবং বৃদ্ধিমান বেকারত্বে। ফলে উৎপাদনশীলতার অভাব এবং ক্ষতিগ্রস্ত মানুষের ও তাদের পরিবারের চিকিৎসা ও পুনর্বাসনের জন্য অতিরিক্ত ব্যয় হচ্ছে। প্রধান অর্থনীতিতে লকডাউনের ফলে প্রত্যেকটা দেশের জিডিপি সরাসরি প্রভাবিত হয়েছে। বার্ষিক জিডিপি বিকাশের মধ্যে আনুমানিক ক্ষতি হচ্ছে 2% প্রতি মাসে। একা পর্যটন খাত আউটপুট হ্রাসের সম্মুখীন হয় প্রায় 50-70% মধ্যে। ওয়ার্ল্ড ট্রেড অর্গানাইজেশন এবং OECD অর্গানাইজেশন অফ ইকোনমিক কোঅপারেশন অ্যান্ড ডেভেলপমেন্ট অনুসারে সূচিত করা হয়েছে যে কোভিড-19 মহামারী আকারে বৈশ্বিক অর্থনীতির বৃহত্তম হুমকি আর্থিক উত্থানের পর থেকে 2008 সাল থেকে 2009 সাল। কিছু বিশেষজ্ঞরা এটাও বলেছেন যে মানব সভ্যতা কখনো এমন অভূতপূর্ণ জরুরি অবস্থার সম্মুখীন হয়নি দ্বিতীয় বিশ্বযুদ্ধের পর থেকে। সুতরাং কোভিড-19 নিঃসন্দেহে ক্ষেপণ করেছে এক লক্ষণীয় খারাপ প্রভাব, যার ফলে আক্রান্ত হয়েছে সমগ্র মানব সমাজের নিয়মিত জীবন এবং সারা বিশ্ব।
সমাজ এক গভীর সংকটময় পরিস্থিতির মধ্যে দিয়ে জীবন অতিবাহিত করছে। এই ভয়ঙ্কর মহামারীর আতঙ্ক আজ ঘিরে রয়েছে গোটা মানব জাতিকে। সকল প্রকার চিন্তা ভাবনার ঊর্ধ্বে গিয়ে মানব জীবনের শৃঙ্খলাটাকে দারুণভাবে বিঘ্নিত করেছে কোভিড-19। আমি পৌশালী পাহাড়ি, ভূগোল অনার্স বিভাগের ছাত্রী, শ্রদ্ধেয় শিক্ষক শিক্ষিকার প্রণাম নিয়ে এই মহামারীর শিক্ষানীতির উপর কিরূপ প্রভাব বিস্তার করেছে তা নিয়ে নিজস্ব কিছু মতামত পেশ করতে চলেছি। এই ভয়ঙ্কর মারণ রোগ কোভিড-19 মানব জাতির স্বাভাবিক জীবনধারাকে প্রতি পদে ও প্রতি ক্ষেত্রে বাধা দান করেছে। কেবল আর্থিক দিক থেকেই নয়, দেশের বিভিন্ন ক্ষেত্রগুলির সাথে শিক্ষাক্ষেত্রের উপরেও এই গভীর ক্ষত সুস্পষ্ট। 2020 সালে বিগত 4-5 মাস ধরে সমগ্র মানব জাতি গৃহবন্দী দশায় আবদ্ধ। এর প্রভাব শিশু থেকে কৈশোর সকলের ক্ষেত্রেই বিরাজমান। সাথে সাথে বিভিন্ন স্তরে শিক্ষার্থীদের পঠন পাঠনে শৃঙ্খলাটাকে বাধাপ্রাপ্ত করেছে। স্কুল এবং কলেজ, বিভিন্ন শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠানগুলি বন্ধ থাকায় লেখাপড়ার গতিশীলতা হ্রাস পায়। তবুও এই অস্বাস্থ্যকর কঠিন সংকটময় পরিস্থিতির মধ্যেও শিক্ষার সুশৃঙ্খল ধারা বজায় রাখার জন্য প্রযুক্তিগত প্রকল্পের সাহায্য নেওয়া হয়েছে। বর্তমান আধুনিকতার এই যুগে বিভিন্ন প্রকার ইলেকট্রনিক্স যেমন স্মার্টফোন, কম্পিউটার, ল্যাপটপ অধিকাংশ বাড়িতেই পাওয়া যায়। শিক্ষার সহজাত ধারা বজায় রাখতে এই আধুনিক যন্ত্রাবলী ও ইন্টারনেট পরিষেবার সাহায্যে অনলাইন ক্লাস প্রকল্পের সূচনা ঘটেছে। তাই বিভিন্ন শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠানগুলি নিজ নিজ ওয়েবসাইট ও বিভিন্ন অ্যাপ্লিকেশনের সাহায্যে শিক্ষার্থীদের সাথে গৃহবন্দীকালীন পরিস্থিতিতেও যে কোনো স্থান থেকে যোগাযোগ করতে সক্ষম হয়েছেন। এই প্রকল্পের দ্বারা শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থার সহজাত ধারা পুরোপুরি স্বাভাবিক গতিতে না আনলেও কিছুটা স্থিতিশীল ও ভারসাম্যে আনা গেছে। অনলাইনে ক্লাস নেওয়া, বিষয়ভিত্তিক ছোট ছোট পরীক্ষা এবং নানা বিষয়ে ছোট ছোট প্রকল্প উপস্থাপনা করা, ক্লাসের পঠন পাঠনের অনুশীলনের মাধ্যমে লেখাপড়ার গতিবিধিকে সচ্ছল রাখার চেষ্টা করা হয়েছে। তবে শিক্ষক শিক্ষিকাদের সাথে শিক্ষার্থীদের অনলাইনে যোগাযোগ স্থাপন সম্ভব হলেও নানা বিষয়ে সমস্যাজনক পরিস্থিতির সৃষ্টি হয়েছে। তবে সকলে এই প্রযুক্তির সুফলতা ভোগ করতে পারে না। অধিকাংশ বাড়িতে আধুনিক যন্ত্রপাতির ব্যবহার থাকলেও সকলে সেই সুবিধা পায় না। আমাদের দেশ অর্থনৈতিক সমস্যা সুদীর্ঘকাল ধরে আমাদের দেশে অর্থনৈতিক সমস্যা সুদীর্ঘকাল ধরে বিরাজমান থাকলেও কোভিড-19 প্রভাবে তার প্রভাব আরও বেড়ে উঠেছে। তাছাড়াও স্থানকাল বিশেষে সুষ্ঠু ইন্টারনেট পরিষেবা প্রাপ্তি সকলে ভোগ করতে পারে না, ফলে শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থার ভারসাম্যহীনতা থেকেই যায়। বিভিন্ন স্থানে ধারাবাহিক পরীক্ষা পদ্ধতি রুদ্ধ হওয়ার দরুন শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থার স্বাভাবিক ছন্দপতন ঘটে, ফলত শিক্ষার্থীদের ভবিষ্যৎ পরিকল্পনায় বাধাপ্রাপ্ত হয়। এর ফলে বিভিন্ন রকম মানসিক চাপ সৃষ্টি হয়। পরিস্থিতির বিশৃঙ্খলতা আর্থিক ও মানসিক উভয় দিক থেকে ক্ষত সৃষ্টি করে, যার গুরুতর প্রভাব শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থাকে প্রতি পদক্ষেপে বিঘ্নতা প্রদান করে। বর্তমানে চূড়ান্ত মারণ রোগ কোভিড-19 শিক্ষার স্বাভাবিক রীতিনীতিকে বিভিন্নভাবে পরিবর্তন ঘটিয়েছে। সুদীর্ঘকাল ধরে প্রচলিত শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থার বদল শিক্ষার্থীদের প্রতিনিয়ত মানসিক চাপের মুখে ফেলেছে, ফলে গৃহীত প্রকল্পের থেকে প্রাপ্ত সুফলতার সাথে সাথেই সমস্যারও সৃষ্টি হয়েছে। ফলত বলাই যায় যে বর্তমান করোনা পরিস্থিতি আমাদের শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থাকেও গুরুতরভাবে আঘাত হেনেছে এবং গভীর প্রভাব ফেলেছে।
অন লেবার 2020 সালে আমাদের জীবনে অসম পরিস্থিতি তৈরি হয়েছে একটি অজানা মারণ রোগকে কেন্দ্র করে। শুধু আমাদের দেশ নয়, সারা বিশ্বে এক শোচনীয় অর্থ সামাজিক অচলাবস্থার সৃষ্টি হয়েছে। রোগের সংক্রমণ ঠেকানোর জন্য পুরো বিশ্ব, সমস্ত কলকারখানা, শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থা, ক্রিয়া জগৎ সব স্থগিত। এর ফলে সারা বিশ্বের অর্থনৈতিক অবস্থা থমকে পড়েছে। এর প্রভাব সারা বিশ্বে কম বা বেশি পড়েছে, তার মধ্যে আমাদের দেশও একটি। আমি সৃঞ্জনা মুখার্জি, বিএসসি জিওগ্রাফি অনার্স স্টুডেন্ট। সকল শ্রদ্ধেয় শিক্ষক শিক্ষিকাকে আমার প্রণাম জানিয়ে আমার উদ্ধৃত বিষয় ইকোনমিক এফেক্ট অন লেবার বা অর্থনৈতিক প্রভাব শ্রমিকদের ওপর COVID-19 জন্য আমার ভিউ দিচ্ছি। আমাদের দেশে প্রায় 487 মিলিয়ন শ্রমিক আছে। 2011 সেনসাস অনুযায়ী আমাদের ভারত দ্বিতীয় স্থান আছে চায়নার পরে। তাদের মধ্যে প্রায় 94% মানুষ কাজ করে অনিয়মিত অসংস্থিত উদ্যোক্তাদের কাছে, যেমন ঠেলাগাড়ি থেকে শেখরা পর্যন্ত অনিয়মিত ও অসংস্থিত সেক্টরে পড়ে। আর বাকি 6% মানুষ সংগঠিত সেক্টর, সরকারি মালিকাধীন উদ্যোক্ত এবং বেসরকারি উদ্যোক্তদের মধ্যে পড়ে। এই লকডাউনের ফলে যেসব মানুষ অনিয়মিত অসংস্থিত সেক্টরে কাজ করে তাদের অনেক ক্ষয়ক্ষতি হয়েছে, কারণ বিশ্বব্যাপী বাজারে বৃদ্ধির হার কমার ফলে আমাদের দেশের অনেক মানুষ কাজ হারিয়েছে। এই অসংগঠিত সেক্টর কর্মরত মানুষদের মধ্যে বেশিরভাগ মানুষই দিন আনি দিন খাই, যেমন হকার্স, রিক্সা চালক, বাস চালক, চাকরা, দিনমজুর ইত্যাদি। মানুষজন খুবই অসুবিধার মধ্যে পড়েছে, যেহেতু তারা প্রতিদিন একটা প্রতিদিন রোজগার করে খায়, এবং লকডাউনের জন্য যখন সব কিছু স্থগিত, তাদের আয়ের রাস্তাও বন্ধ হয়ে যায়। সাধারণত এই শ্রমজীবী মানুষদের কাছ থেকে সঞ্চয় খুব কম থাকে। দীর্ঘ লকডাউনের ফলে সেই সময় সেই সঞ্চয় কিছুদিনের মধ্যে শেষ হয়ে যায় এবং তাদের জীবিকা অর্জনের জন্য অনেক ভোগান্তি দিয়ে যেতে হচ্ছে। এছাড়াও আমাদের দেশে যে পরিযায়ী শ্রমিক আছে, এই COVID-19 হওয়ার ফলে তাদেরও অনেক বাধা বিপত্তি দিয়ে যেতে হয়েছে। যেহেতু কল কারখানা বন্ধ, তাদেরকে ভিন্ন রাজ্য থেকে নিজেদের রাজ্যে, অর্থাৎ এক রাজ্য থেকে নিজেদের রাজ্যে ফিরতে বাধ্য হচ্ছে। এই সময় যেহেতু সব যানবাহন পরিষেবা বন্ধ ছিল, তাই এই সব শ্রমিকেরা পায়ে হেঁটে বাড়ি ফিরতে বাধ্য হচ্ছে। এই সময় তাদের কোনো আয়ের ব্যবস্থা ছিল না। চারিদিকে সমস্ত দোকানপাট বন্ধ থাকায় তাদের খাওয়ার ও থাকার কোনো ব্যবস্থা ছিল না। এই সমস্ত পরিস্থিতি দিয়ে যাওয়ার ফলে অনেকেই বাড়ি ফিরতে গিয়ে প্রাণ হারিয়েছে। আমাদের দেশে সরকারি গণনা অনুযায়ী প্রায় 300 জন পরিযায়ী শ্রমিকের মৃত্যু হয়েছে। এছাড়াও অনেক পরিযায়ী শ্রমিক রাস্তায় বিপর্যয়েতে মারা গেছে, যেমন 16 মে 2020-তে 26 জন পরিযায়ী শ্রমিক মারা যায় ট্রেন দুর্ঘটনায়। এর কিছুদিন পর আরও এক মর্মান্তিক দৃশ্য আমাদের সামনে আসে, যেখানে একটি রেলওয়ে স্টেশনে সিসিটিভিতে ধরা পড়ে একটি 3 বছরের বাচ্চা মেয়ে তার মৃত মাকে ডেকে ওঠাবার চেষ্টা করছে। বেসরকারি উদ্যোক্তাদের মধ্যে এই COVID-19 পরিস্থিতির জন্য ভারতবর্ষ অধিকাংশ বেসরকারি সংস্থাগুলো তাদের কর্মী ছাঁটাই বা তাদের কর্মীদের সাময়িক দেওয়ার সিদ্ধান্ত নিয়েছেন, যার ফলে এই সব সংস্থাদের কর্মীদের অর্থনৈতিক টানাপোড়েন দিয়ে যেতে হচ্ছে। একটি বেসরকারি সংস্থা রিপোর্ট অনুযায়ী 64% বেসরকারি উদ্যোক্তারা ইতিমধ্যে কর্মী ছাঁটাইয়ের অথবা সাময়িক ছুটি দেওয়ার প্রক্রিয়া শুরু করে দিয়েছে। আরও একটি বেসরকারি সংস্থার গণনা অনুযায়ী 73% বেসরকারি সংস্থা একটির মধ্যে পরিকল্পনা করেছে কর্মীদের বেতন কমাবার জন্য, আর 21% কোম্পানি তাদের কর্মীদের অন্তত 2 বছরের জন্য বেতন স্থায়ীভাবে সাময়িক ছুটি দেওয়ার সিদ্ধান্ত নিয়েছেন। গ্রস ডোমেস্টিক প্রোডাক্ট বা জিডিপি, মোট দেশীয় পণ্য। পৃথিবীব্যাপী করোনা ভাইরাসের ফলে পুরো পৃথিবীর অর্থনৈতিক বাজারে অনেক ক্ষয়ক্ষতি হয়েছে। মিনিস্ট্রি অফ স্ট্যাটিস্টিক অনুযায়ী 2020 সালে মোট দেশীয় পণ্য 3.1% নিম্নগামী হয়েছে, যার ফলে বেকারত্ব বেড়েছে, সরকারি আয় কমেছে, তাছাড়া ভ্রমণ ব্যবস্থাও ক্ষতি হয়েছে। এছাড়া নানা রকমের অর্থনৈতিক ক্ষয়ক্ষতি হয়েছে।
আমাদের শিক্ষা জগতের ওপর নোবেল করোনা ভাইরাসের প্রভাব। বর্তমানে মানব জাতি এক কঠিন দুর্দশাময় পরিস্থিতির মধ্যে দিয়ে জীবন অতিবাহিত করছে। এই ভয়ানক মারণ রোগ কোভিড-19 সকলের ভাবনা চিন্তার ঊর্ধ্বে গিয়ে মানব জীবনের স্বাভাবিক গতিকে বিঘ্নিত করেছে। আমি স্নেহা ঘোষ, ভূগোল অনার্স বিভাগের ছাত্রী, শ্রদ্ধেয় শিক্ষক শিক্ষিকার প্রণাম জানিয়ে এই মহামারী শিক্ষা জগতের ওপর কিরূপ প্রভাব বিস্তার করেছে তা নিয়ে নিজ মত পেশ করতে চলেছি। মহামারী কোভিড-19, এই ভয়ানক মারণ রোগ, মানব জীবনের ধারাকে প্রতি ক্ষেত্রে বিঘ্নিত করেছে। এর মধ্যে শিক্ষা জগতের ওপরও যথেষ্ট গভীর প্রভাব পড়েছে। সুদীর্ঘ কাল ধরে সকলেই আজ গৃহবন্দী। বিভিন্ন স্তরে শিক্ষার্থীদের পঠন পাঠনের স্বাভাবিক ধারা রুদ্ধ হয়েছে। স্কুল কলেজ শিক্ষা সংস্থাগুলি বন্ধ থাকায় লেখাপড়ার গতিশীলতা হ্রাস পায়। তবে এই অস্বস্তিকর পরিস্থিতির মধ্যে শিক্ষার গতিশীলতার ভারসাম্যের জন্য প্রযুক্তিগত প্রকল্পে সাহায্য নেওয়া হয়েছে। বর্তমানে আধুনিক যুগে বিভিন্ন ইলেকট্রনিক্স, বিশেষত স্মার্টফোন, কম্পিউটার, ল্যাপটপ বেশিরভাগ বাড়িতেই পাওয়া যায়। শিক্ষার ধারা বজায় রাখতে এই আধুনিক যন্ত্র ও ইন্টারনেট পরিষেবার সাহায্যে অনলাইন ক্লাস প্রকল্পে সাহায্য নেওয়া হয়েছে। তাই শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠানগুলি বিভিন্ন ওয়েবসাইট ও বিভিন্ন অ্যাপের সাহায্যে শিক্ষার্থীদের সাথে ঘরবন্দী দশায়ও সরাসরি যোগাযোগ স্থাপন করতে সক্ষম হয়েছে। এর মাধ্যমে শিক্ষার ধারা সম্পূর্ণ স্বাভাবিক গতিতে না এলেও পরিস্থিতি কিছুটা স্থিতিশীল করা গেছে। অনলাইনে ক্লাস এবং বিভিন্ন ছোট পরীক্ষা ও বাড়ি থেকে বিষয়ভিত্তিক কার্য দ্বারা লেখাপড়ার গতিকে সচ্ছল রাখার চেষ্টা চলছে। তবে শিক্ষার্থীর সাথে শিক্ষক শিক্ষিকার যোগাযোগ স্থাপন হলেও অনেক ক্ষেত্রে সমস্যাও পরিলক্ষিত হয়েছে। বেশিরভাগ বাড়িতেই ইলেকট্রনিক্স যন্ত্রের ব্যবহার থাকলেও সকলে তার সুবিধা লাভ করতে পারে না। আর্থিক সমস্যার দৃঢ়তা এই কোভিড-19 প্রভাবে বেড়েছে। তাছাড়াও সুলভ ইন্টারনেট পরিষেবারও প্রয়োজন, যা সব স্থানে পাওয়া সম্ভব নয়। তাছাড়াও ভবিষ্যৎ পরিকল্পনায় বাধা সৃষ্টি হয়। ধারাবাহিক পরীক্ষা পদ্ধতি রুদ্ধ হওয়ায় শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থার স্বাভাবিক ছন্দপতন ঘটে। সুদৃঢ় ভবিষ্যৎ চিন্তায় মানসিক চাপ বৃদ্ধি পায়। পরিস্থিতির অস্থিতিশীলতা আর্থিক ও মানসিক চাপ সৃষ্টি করে, যা থেকে শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থাও মুক্ত নয়। বর্তমানে করোনা সংক্রমণের ফলে শিক্ষা রীতিনীতিতে বিভিন্ন পরিবর্তন ঘটে। শিক্ষার স্বাভাবিক ধারায় পরিবর্তন হচ্ছে, যার ফলে শিক্ষার্থীদের চিন্তা বাড়ছে, যা মানসিক চাপের অন্যতম কারণ। ফলে একদিকে সুফলতার সাথে সমস্যাও সৃষ্টি হচ্ছে। ফলত বলাই যায় কোভিড-19 প্রভাব শিক্ষার ওপর গভীরভাবে প্রভাব ফেলেছে। নমস্কার।
করোনা ভাইরাস, অর্থাৎ যেটা চীনের উহান প্রদেশে প্রথম দেখা যায়, যা বিশ্বের কাছে কোভিড-19 নামে পরিচিত। ভাইরাসটি চীনে 2019 ডিসেম্বর মাসের শেষের দিকে দেখা যায় এবং ধীরে ধীরে যা বিশ্বের অধিকাংশ দেশের মধ্যে ছড়িয়ে যেতে থাকে। মোট 190টি দেশে এর প্রকোপ দেখা। আমাদের দেশ অর্থাৎ ভারতবর্ষের রাজধানী দিল্লিতে মার্চ মাসের প্রথম এই করোনা ভাইরাসের প্রকোপ দেখা যায়। তারপর ধীরে ধীরে ভারতের বিভিন্ন রাজ্যের মধ্যে এই ভাইরাসটি ছড়িয়ে পড়তে থাকে। এতে সাধারণ মানুষ খুব বিপর্যয়ের মুখে পড়ে। কঠিন পরিস্থিতির কথা মাথায় রেখে আমাদের কেন্দ্রীয় সরকার 22 মার্চ জনতা কারফিউ এবং তারপরে 21 দিনের টানা লকডাউন অর্থাৎ গৃহবন্দি থাকার নির্দেশ দেন। দেশের বিভিন্ন প্রান্তে থাকা মানুষ নিজেদের বাসস্থানে না ফিরতে পেরে কঠিন সমস্যার সম্মুখীন হন। ফলে মানুষের ব্যবসা বাণিজ্য, শিক্ষা ব্যবস্থা, সংযোগ মাধ্যম অর্থাৎ যাতায়াত ব্যবস্থার উপর বিরাট প্রভাব পড়ে। মানুষের আর্থিক ব্যবস্থা ভেঙে পড়তে থাকে, ব্যবসা বাণিজ্যে বিরাট মন্দা দেখা যায়, সমস্ত ব্যবসা প্রায় বন্ধ হয়ে যাওয়ার উপক্রম হয়। ফলে সাধারণ মানুষ ভীষণ বিপদের সম্মুখীন হয়েছে। আজ গৃহবন্দী থাকার ফলে মানুষের ব্যবসা বাণিজ্যে বিরাট ক্ষতি দেখা দিয়েছে। এই অর্থনৈতিক সংকট সাধারণ মানুষের জীবনে এক বিরাট পরিবর্তন এনে দিয়েছে এবং এই সকলের সাথে সাথে আমাদের দেশের অর্থাৎ ভারতবর্ষের আর্থিক সংকটও দেখা দিয়েছে। ব্যবসা বাণিজ্যের সাথে সাথে দেশের সমস্ত যাতায়াত ব্যবস্থা অর্থাৎ বিমান ব্যবস্থা, রেল ব্যবস্থা, সড়ক ব্যবস্থা সবকিছুই আজ বন্ধ। বিভিন্ন জায়গা পাশ দিয়ে ঘিরে দেওয়া হয়েছে এই মারণ ভাইরাসের হাত থেকে বাঁচার জন্য। ভাইরাসকে ছড়িয়ে পড়া থেকে আটকানোর জন্য ভারতের বেশিরভাগ স্কুল কলেজই আজ বন্ধ। সকলেই আজ অনলাইনের উপর নির্ভরশীল। এই অনলাইনের মাধ্যমে শিক্ষার্থীরা তাদের শিক্ষক শিক্ষিকার সাথে যোগাযোগকে বজায় রেখেছে এবং নিজেদের পড়াশোনাকে এগিয়ে নিয়ে যাওয়ার চেষ্টা চালাচ্ছে। এই মারণ রোগ থেকে রোগীকে সুস্থ করে তুলতে আজ আমাদের দেশের অনেক স্বাস্থ্যকর্মী, ডাক্তার নিজেদের জীবন দিয়েছেন। এই মারণ রোগ যাতে আর ছড়িয়ে না পড়ে তাই সকলেই সরকারের নির্দেশ মেনে চলুন, মাস্ক পরুন এবং সকলের থেকে দূরত্ব বজায় রেখে চলুন। সকলে সুস্থ থাকুন এবং ভালো থাকুন।
করোনা ভাইরাস বা কোভিড-19 বিশ্ব স্বাস্থ্য সংস্থা অর্থাৎ হু সবার আগে গত জানুয়ারিতে করোনা ভাইরাসের প্রাদুর্ভাবকে একটি বিশ্ব স্বাস্থ্য সংকট হিসেবে ঘোষণা করেছিলেন। সর্বপ্রথম এই ভাইরাসের সংক্রমণ ঘটে চীনের উহান প্রদেশে। অল্প সময়ের মধ্যে এটি ছড়িয়ে পড়ে বিশ্বের 190টি দেশে। মার্চের মধ্যে এই সংক্রমণ চীন থেকে স্থানান্তরিত হয়ে ইউরোপে এবং বিশেষত ইতালি ও স্পেনেও ছড়িয়ে পড়ে। এপ্রিলে এর আঘাত শুরু হয় যুক্তরাষ্ট্রে। এইভাবে ছড়িয়ে পড়ে করোনা ভাইরাসের তাণ্ডব কম বেশি 190টি দেশে। এই তাণ্ডবের ভবিষ্যৎ রূপ কি তা সত্যি আমরা এখনো পর্যন্ত জানি না। জানি না এর শেষ কোথায়। কিন্তু কিন্তু করোনা প্রতিরোধের অংশ হিসেবে 80টিরও বেশি দেশ বন্ধ করে দেয় তার আন্তর্জাতিক সীমান্ত আর বিমানবন্দর। এমনকি বন্ধ করে দেওয়া হয় বিভিন্ন অর্থনৈতিক প্রতিষ্ঠান, কলকারখানা ও শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠানগুলিও। সার্বিক কর্মকাণ্ডে নেমে আসে এক অভাবনীয় স্থবিরতা। জনগণকে বলা হয় নিজ নিজ হোম আইসোলেশনে থাকতে। কোনো কোনো দেশে জারি করা হয় বিশ্বব্যাপী লকডাউন। এইভাবে করোনার প্রাদুর্ভাব বিশ্বব্যাপী তছনছ করে দেয় পুরো বিশ্বের সামাজিক, অর্থনৈতিক, রাজনৈতিক এবং ধর্মীয় ব্যবস্থাগুলি। ছোট ছোট অর্থনীতির দেশ তো বটেই, এমনকি যুক্তরাজ্য, যুক্তরাষ্ট্র, চীন, জাপান, জার্মানি, ফ্রান্সের মতো বড় বড় অর্থনীতির দেশেও এর ব্যাপক নেতিবাচক প্রভাব পড়ে। বিশ্বব্যাপী শেয়ার বাজারে নামে ধস। তেলের দাম হঠাৎ করে ঘটে ব্যাপক পতন। ওয়ার্ল্ড ট্রেড ইউনিয়ন 8ই এপ্রিল জানায় করোনার প্রভাবে বিশ্ব বাণিজ্যের পরিমাণ 2020 সালে 13-32% কমে যেতে পারে। এই সংস্থা আরো বলেছেন 2020 সালে বিশ্ব বাণিজ্যের পরিমাণ 2008-2009 সময়ের বিশ্ব অর্থনীতি মন্দার চেয়েও কম যেতে পারে। এর পাশাপাশি অনেক অর্থনীতিবিদ এবং সংশ্লিষ্ট বিশেষজ্ঞরা বিশ্ব অর্থনৈতিক ও আর্থিক কাঠামোর করুণ পরিণতি ব্যাপারে আমাদের জন্য সতর্কবাণী মাঝে মাঝেই বলেছেন। তারা বলেছেন, করোনার আঘাত বিশ্ব অর্থনৈতিক মন্দার চেয়েও আর্থিক মন্দাতে খারাপ হবে। তারা এটাও বলেছেন, দ্বিতীয় বিশ্বযুদ্ধের পরবর্তী সময়ে এটি হচ্ছে সব থেকে ভয়াবহ অর্থনৈতিক পরিস্থিতি যা আমাদের আজ মোকাবিলা করতে হচ্ছে। এছাড়াও এটি একটি স্বাস্থ্য সংকটময় পরিস্থিতি। এটি বিশ্বের সরকারকে বাধ্য করেছে মানুষের জীবন বাঁচানোর জন্য ব্যাপক কর্মসূচি গ্রহণ করতে। বিশ্ব বাণিজ্য সংস্থার মহাপরিচালক বলেছেন, এর ওপর আছে উৎপাদন ও বাণিজ্য পতনের অপরিহার্য দুঃখজনক পরিণতি। এর ফলে দুর্ভোগ সমভাবে পতিত ব্যবসা ও বাণিজ্য এবং বিভিন্ন পরিবারের ওপর। করোনা রোগের দুর্ভোগ ও চলছে সমান্তরালভাবে। এই করোনা ভাইরাস সম্পর্কিত একটি ছোট্ট ভিডিও।
The virus was reported in Wuhan, China in December 2019. Early cases were believed to be linked to a live animal market in Wuhan and have since been spreading from person to person. Shortly after, cases of the virus began to appear outside of China, and on January 20th, 2020, the first case of novel coronavirus was reported in the United States. On January 30th, the World Health Organization declared the outbreak a public health emergency of international concern.
More cases should be expected in other parts of China and possibly other countries.
Coronaviruses are a large family of viruses, named for their shape, protruding spikes that look like a crown or a corona. SARS and MERS are part of the coronavirus family, as well as viruses that cause the common cold. The 2019 novel coronavirus was officially named COVID-19 on February 11th by the World Health Organization. Suspected community spread was first reported in the United States on February 26th, with no known links to people who've traveled to Wuhan, China. WHO said on February 27th that COVID-19 has pandemic potential.
This virus does not respect borders.
COVID-19 can cause flu-like symptoms that range from mild to severe, including cough, fever, and shortness of breath. Since the infection can include symptoms similar to pneumonia, influenza, and the common cold, only a diagnostic test can confirm whether or not an individual is positive for the virus. Thousands of people have died around the world. The first deaths in the United States occurred on February 26th. There are trials underway for treatments, but vaccines are still in the development phase and likely more than a year away. CDC officials say that Americans should prepare for major disruptions to their daily routines. Recommendations to reduce the risk of infection include
Thank you, Pooja and Atri. Hope this one was the last video. Hello? আপনাদের ভালো লেগেছে, এদের ভুল ত্রুটি ক্ষমা করে দেবেন, কারণ এরা একেবারেই নতুন, কিন্তু আমার তো মনে হচ্ছে আমাদের অনেকের চেয়ে অনেক ভালোভাবে এরা প্রেজেন্ট করেছে।
সোনালি দি,
হ্যাঁ ইয়েস ম্যাডাম,
আপনার বলা হলে আমি একটু বলবো।
হ্যাঁ আপনি বলুন, আপনি বলুন,
আপনি বলুন, বলে নিন আগে।
আচ্ছা, আমাদের আপনাদের সবাইকে জানিয়ে রাখছি, নেক্সট টুমরো আমাদের আবার প্রোগ্রাম আছে এবং সেখানে আমাদের আরো কিছু স্টুডেন্ট লাস্টের দিকে প্রেজেন্ট করবে। থ্যাংক ইউ ম্যাডাম, ইউ ক্যান নাও প্রসিড।
আজকে একটি বিশেষ সমস্যার মধ্যে থাকার জন্য আমি প্রথমে থাকতে পারিনি পুরোটা, কিন্তু তারপরে ইকোনমিক্স ডিপার্টমেন্টের বিভাগীয় প্রধান আমাকে জানালেন যে ছাত্রীরা বলছে। তো একটি কলেজের অধ্যক্ষা হিসেবে আমার মনে হয়েছে যে ছাত্রীরা বলবে আর অধ্যক্ষা অর্থাৎ কলেজের অভিভাবক হিসেবে যিনি রয়েছেন তিনি থাকবেন না, তার থেকে বড় অন্যায় আর কিছু হয় না। সেই জন্য সমস্ত সমস্যাকে পাশে সরিয়ে রেখে আমি ছাত্রীদের প্রেজেন্টেশন শুনলাম। আমি সত্যিই গর্বিত যে ছাত্রীরা, আমাদের কলেজ বলে বলছি না, যে কলেজ থেকেই তারা আসুন, ছাত্র বা ছাত্রীরা তাদের বৌদ্ধিক সত্তার বিকাশ সত্যি প্রশংসার দাবি রাখে। বিভিন্ন ছাত্রী বিভিন্ন ভাবে বলেছেন, কেউ বলেছে শিক্ষা নিয়ে, কেউ পরিযায়ী শ্রমিকদের নিয়ে, অর্থনীতিতে সমস্যার নানান দিক নিয়ে। কিন্তু একটা বিশেষ বিষয় আমি উল্লেখ করব যে এটাকেই বোধহয় যে কোনো সমস্যার সিলভার লাইনিং বলা হয়। অর্থাৎ আমি এই কলেজে 5 বছর আছি এবং এর আগেও বহুদিন অধ্যাপনার সঙ্গে জড়িত। আমাদের কেমিস্ট্রি ডিপার্টমেন্ট এবং ইকোনমিক্স ডিপার্টমেন্ট যেভাবে ছাত্রীদের উৎসাহিত করে এইভাবে প্রেজেন্ট করালো, এটা বোধহয় COVID-19 সিলভার লাইনিং। আমরা অনেকবার চেষ্টা করেছি নানান রকম প্রেজেন্টেশনের জন্য, কিন্তু এত উৎসাহ এবং এত সুন্দর প্রেজেন্টেশন আমার জীবনে, এটা কিন্তু একটা বড় প্রাপ্তি। আমার শিক্ষক জীবনের এটা একটা বড় প্রাপ্তি। তারা পড়াশোনা করেছে, তারা পাওয়ার পয়েন্ট তৈরি করেছে এবং তারা অত্যন্ত মনোজ্ঞ বক্তব্য উপস্থাপনা করেছে। আমরা আশা করছি এই নিউ নর্মালের পরে সত্যি একটা নর্মাল বা স্বাভাবিক জায়গায় পৌঁছবো। আমি আজকের যারা উদ্যোক্তা, বিশেষ করে ডক্টর সোনালি মুখার্জি এবং ডক্টর অমৃতা ব্যানার্জিকে অনুরোধ করব যে আমরা ছাত্রীদের, সেদিন শুধু ছাত্রীরাই বলবে আমরা শুনব, আমি সমস্ত বক্তাদের ধন্যবাদ দেওয়া বা আনুষ্ঠানিক ধন্যবাদের যে বিষয়টি সেটার জন্য রয়েছেন ডক্টর লিপিকা মল্লিক, আমি অধ্যক্ষা হিসেবে সকলকে ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি, কৃতজ্ঞতা জানাচ্ছি। কিন্তু আমি বিশেষ করে ধন্যবাদ জানাবো আমার স্নেহের ছাত্রীদের, আমার অতি ভালোবাসার ছাত্রীদের এবং তাদের যে অধ্যাপিকারা উৎসাহিত করেছেন তাদের। তোমরা সকলে খুব ভালো থাকো, সুস্থ থাকো। COVID-19 একটা ভীষণ সমস্যার সৃষ্টি করেছে আমাদের স্বাস্থ্য, আমাদের অর্থনীতি, আমাদের সংস্কৃতি, আমাদের পারিবারিক জীবনকে বিপর্যস্ত করে তুলেছে। কিন্তু তার সঙ্গে এটাও ঠিক, আমাদের প্রযুক্তি শিখিয়েছে, আমাদের সমস্যার মধ্যে বাঁচতে শিখিয়েছে, আমাদের সমস্যা এবং জটিলতা কাটিয়ে উঠে কিভাবে নতুন সূর্যোদয় দেখব সেই প্রত্যাশা করতে শিখিয়েছে। এবং আমার মনে হয়েছে আমার কলেজে শিক্ষক এবং ছাত্রীরা COVID-19 এই চ্যালেঞ্জকে মোকাবিলা করতে গিয়ে অনেক বেশি পরস্পরের কাছাকাছি এসেছে। আমি আবার সকলকে ধন্যবাদ জানিয়ে ডক্টর সোনালি মুখার্জিকে হ্যান্ড ওভার করব।
থ্যাংক ইউ ম্যাডাম। একটাই কথা বলার যে আমি যা পারিনি আমার ছাত্রীরা বোধহয় তা পেরেছে। আমি কিন্তু এত ভালোভাবে কিছু প্রেজেন্ট করতে পারি না, আমার ছাত্রীরা পেরেছে। থ্যাংক ইউ। নাও মে আই রিকোয়েস্ট ডক্টর লিপিকা মল্লিক আওয়ার বার স্যার টু গিভ হার ভোট অফ থ্যাংকস। হ্যালো। ওকে, থ্যাংক ইউ
সোনালিদি। আমি বাংলায় বলছি,
আমরা তো সবাই বাঙালি, বাংলা ছাড়া আর গতি কি, বাংলাতেই বলুন।
হ্যাঁ ঠিক আছে, শুরু করছি। অনেক প্রতীক্ষার পরে আজকের আলোচনার সার্থক আয়োজন সম্ভব হলো। বিদগ্ধ বক্তাদের বক্তব্যের গভীরতা চিন্তাসূত্র নতুন ভাবনার অবকাশ তৈরি করেছে। ধন্যবাদ জানানো নিছক আনুষ্ঠানিকতা মাত্র, শিক্ষার্থী হিসেবে আরো অনেক জানবার আগ্রহ রইল। ধন্যবাদ জানাবো অর্থনীতি ও রসায়ন বিভাগকে যাদের উদ্যোগে এই আয়োজন। অধ্যাপিকা সোনালি মুখার্জির নেতৃত্বে ও অধ্যাপিকা অমৃতা ব্যানার্জির উদ্যোগে এই আলোচনা সভা সকলের মননকে আলোড়িত করেছে। বক্তব্যের প্রাঞ্জল ও স্বচ্ছন্দ গতি বিশেষ প্রশংসার দাবি রাখে। প্রত্যাশা করব যাতে নতুন স্বাভাবিক আমাদের জীবনকে নতুন ছন্দে নতুন সুরের বন্ধনে বাঁধতে পারে, যাতে ওয়েবিনার নয় সেমিনার করে গগনের বিকিরণকে আরও দীপ্তিময় করা যায়। কলেজের এই দুই বিভাগের বৌদ্ধিক বিকাশের আগ্রহ কলেজকে নিশ্চয়ই আরও অগ্রগতির দিকে নিয়ে যাবে। বিশেষ ধন্যবাদ জানাই আমাদের অধ্যক্ষা ডক্টর সোমা ঘোষকে, যার অনুপ্রেরণায় সমস্ত কাজ হয়ে চলেছে। ধন্যবাদ জানাবো ওয়েবিনার অর্গানাইজিং কমিটি ও টেকনিক্যাল কোঅর্ডিনেটরদের, যাদের সহযোগিতা ছাড়া এই আয়োজন সম্ভব ছিল না। আইকিউএসসি এবং আইকিউএসসির কোঅর্ডিনেটরকে ধন্যবাদ। সকল পার্টিসিপেন্ট এবং শিক্ষক শিক্ষিকা, ছাত্রীরা ও শিক্ষা বন্ধুদের ধন্যবাদ ও অভিনন্দন জানিয়ে আমার বক্তব্য শেষ করব। নমস্কার, সকলকে ধন্যবাদ।
থ্যাংক ইউ অ্যান্ড গুড নাইট টু অল।